Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies for this morning's meeting. The first item today is to continue taking evidence on the Gender Recognition Scotland Bill. And I welcome to the meeting our first panel, Professor Alice Sullivan, Head of Research, UCL Social Research Institute, who is joining us virtually, and Robin White, Barrister at Old Square Chambers. I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I'll invite our witnesses to make short opening statements, starting with Professor Sullivan, please.
Fundamental demographic variable and a powerful predictor of almost every dimension of social life. Sex is a protected characteristic under the Equality Act 2010, and it's essential for equalities monitoring. EA 2010 includes a public sector equality duty to monitor and publish data on the protected characteristic of sex. We need consistent and accurate data on sex, make comparisons over time and between countries, and to evaluate the effect of policy interventions. Sex is not the same thing as gender identity, and we need data on both these variables. I'm a quantitative social scientist with over 20 years of experience in the collection and analysis of population data. Between 2010 and 2020, I was director of the 1970 British cohort study, often described as one of the jewels in the crown of British social science. My views on the importance of sex as a basic variable which needs to be collected in both administrative and survey data are not controversial among quantitative social scientists. In 2019, 80 quantitative social scientists signed a letter I coordinated to the UK Census authorities expressing concern regarding their plans to advise respondents that they may respond to the sex question in the census in terms of their self-identified gender identity. The signatories included demographers, epidemiologists, statisticians, sociologists, and economists. They included 10 fellows of the British Academy and several past and present leaders of major data sets. In 2021, Scotland's chief statistician released draft guidance stating that public bodies should not routinely collect data on sex. 91 eminent quantitative social scientists signed a letter I coordinated objecting to this guidance. These objections were ignored. Final guidance states that data on biological sex should only be recorded in a small number of instances. In contrast to this, the UK Statistics Authority guidance recommends that sex, age, and ethnic group should be routinely collected and reported in all administrative data and in-service process data, and should clearly distinguish between the concepts of sex, gender, and gender identity. One might assume that there's no reason why the legislation we're considering would affect data collection. This would be an understandable assumption, but it would be a mistake. When the 2004 Gender Recognition Act was introduced, it was designed to cater to a tiny number of transsexual people suffering severe psychological distress. The Act was not intended to raise barriers to the collection of data on sex. And yet this has been one of the unintended consequences of the legislation. Public bodies have taken the message from the wording of Section 9 that people can switch legal sex over their lifetime, not just for certain legal purposes, but completely. And Section 22 of the Act has contributed to over-caution on the collection of data on sex. Legislators must give serious consideration to the likelihood that introducing gender self-declaration in law will reinforce an existing reluctance to ask about sex. And even small numbers of cases where sex is misclassified can introduce substantial error in data analysis, particularly in cases where sex differentials are large, such as crime statistics. And the number of trans-identified people has risen rapidly, particularly among youth, especially girls. According to a large US study, 1 in 2,000 female undergraduates identified as transgender in 2008, but this rose to 5% in 2021. And the experiences of these young people are so important. We need accurate data on sex as well as gender identity, to understand their outcomes, both for those who medically transition and the majority who don't. Yet even within the health system, this data is being erased. For example, the well-being of children transitioning at the GIDS service has not been followed up over time because their NHS number changes post-transition. Where organisations adopt legal sex as an apparently safer category to ask than sex itself, as happened in the census in England and Wales, larger numbers of people with GRCs under self-declaration will imply a larger impact on data collection and analysis. And finally, without data on sex as well as gender identity, we will not be able to evaluate the impact of the proposed reform. Serious policy evaluation will be rendered unfeasible. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sullivan. And Robin White, please.
Good morning. I'm a barrister practising from Old Square Chambers in London. I'm also a trans woman, the first to transition in practice at the UK Discrimination Bar. And I've split this statement into the professional and personal. And I've provided a longer form of the statement via the administration to keep within the two-minute guideline. Professional. I practice in employment and discrimination law, and I act across the whole UK, including the Scottish tribunals. And I act for pursuer and defender with approximately equal frequency. And that includes trans cases. And in the longer form statement, I've given some examples, a couple of cases in each direction. The Legal Directory, Chambers and Partners has described me as the go-to lawyer for trans cases. I write, speak and lecture regularly on trans matters. And in May 2021, I published a practical guide to transgender law jointly with my Chambers colleague, Nicola Newbegin. I gave evidence to the Westminster Women and Equality Select Committee investigation into reform of the Gender Recognition Act in February 2021. Personal. It's both an honour and a responsibility to be one of the few trans professionals giving evidence to this committee. I would undoubtedly qualify for a gender recognition certificate, but have not applied for one, principally because I regard the current process as demeaning. I am who I am, and I need no one else to validate that for me. I would not have the same difficulty with a process which respected my own declaration of who I am. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Robin. So we'll now move on to questions, starting with Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe. Good morning to the panel. Thank you both for being with us this morning. Thank you for the evidence you've provided in your opening statements and in writing as well. I've got a couple of questions to explore, and I'll start with Alice, if that's okay. I know others are going to come on and talk more about data, so I'm going to keep my questions initially around the need for change, or the case for change. Alice, can you tell us, in your view, is there a requirement to change for this reform in the first place? And you talked a lot about the implications for data, but I suppose, do you see there being a need for change if we can get some of the data stuff right? And I appreciate that other people will talk about the data stuff in a moment. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I am going to stick to my expertise, which is about data. So the proposed reform would reduce the age of eligibility to age 16 and remove all gatekeeping for a GRC. So effectively, this is then based on self-identification. And what that means is that you're opening up what was a very small group of people suffering particular psychological distress to a potentially much larger group of people and a more diverse group of people as well. And as I've said, that does have implications for data collection. It decouples sex, you know, biological sex, natal sex, from legal sex for a larger group of people. We don't know how many, and we don't know how they'll be distributed in the population. And what that means is that when organisations choose to collect legal sex rather than biological sex, the impact will be much larger because there'll be a much larger group of people for whom those two things are decoupled. Now, given the rapid growth of trans identities among youth...
Can I just come in there on
yeah.
that point there? You talk about the shift to self-ID will remove any gatekeeping. And can I just ask what would you envisage that gatekeeping? Do you think the only legitimate gatekeeping is the current gender recognition panel that assesses the dysphoria diagnosis?
So I don't really want to comment on that because that's not my expertise. My expertise is about data collection, and I assume that I've been invited here to give you my expertise rather than my opinions. So I'm not going to comment on exactly what the gatekeeping should look like. All I want to say is that if you greatly open out the group of people for whom sex and legal sex are decoupled, then that will have implications for data collection, particularly where organisations are already anxious about asking for people's biological sex, their natal sex, what we would normally just call their sex, as opposed to their legal sex. And I think the implications of the legal age thing are particularly important, particularly when it comes to data on youth. So, for example, you might think of education data, but actually any other data where you're thinking about youth outcomes. I mean, mental health, for example, is a massive area of policy concern for youth. And we need to know, we know that both for trans people and for girls, there's particular young people are having particular mental health problems. So we want accurate data on both gender identity and sex to follow these things up. And I think it's really important that we consider the longitudinal life course perspective, which is a really fundamental principle of social science research, which seeks to understand people's lives over time. So if we erase natal sex from our data on trans people, we make it impossible to understand their life course and the obstacles they may face. And we also need to consider the possibility gender identity might be particularly fluid for this group, which could then, lead to individuals changing their gender identity back and forth. That's absolutely fine, no problem with that, but their sex remains fixed. And so we really need data on that.
Thanks. I'm aware that there are a couple of other of my colleagues who want to drill down into some of the data questions, and you are covering some of that. But I suppose I'd just hand back to the convener by saying that there are different processes here, I think, around data collection versus the process for the GRC, for obtaining a GRC, and I'm not sure that we necessarily need to conflate them in this way. But I'll leave it there for now.
Okay, Joe. Thanks very much. Can we now go to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to our panel. Thank you for the question you've answered so far, Professor Sullivan, and also for the evidence that you've both given ahead of today. My first question is for Professor Sullivan as well, and it's around data. And I'm wondering, what have you learned from your research colleagues in other parts of the world where self-identification has been in place for some years, and what impact have they found on data collection?
The answer to that is that it's impossible to evaluate the impact on data collection when you lose data on sex. So we can only evaluate and model the impact on data collection from data sets where we've got both. So, for example, I referred in my opening statement to a data set which shows that there's been a big increase in trans identities, particularly among young and highly educated young women, more so than among highly educated young men. Now, if that data set hadn't had information on the sex of the students as well as their gender identity, you simply wouldn't be able to say that. And so then even modeling the effect on data collection becomes impossible. And that's, I think this is such a vital point, because it's not just having the data, accurate data on both sex and gender identity, is essential to monitoring the impact of reform out there in the world, whether it's in sports, in prisons, in education, but it's also essential to monitoring the data quality So if we lose the data, we can't even monitor the data quality.
Thank you for that. Is it possible, convener, to ask a question to both witnesses?
Yep.
Thank you. So my next question is for you both, and it's actually, you've already touched on it, Professor Sullivan, when you mentioned Section 22 of the legislation. So I'm just keen to know from both of you, what are your views on how the proposed changes would affect single-sex spaces, but also some people have said that our laws are different and not comparable with other parts of the world because of Section 22 on protected information. So what is your understanding of the impact of the changes proposed on this part of the legislation and how other countries have handled similar situations? Maybe we could start with Robin, because you've not spoken.
Yeah, I don't have great experience of the legal systems abroad. I can speak about the legal system in the United Kingdom. What I have noted is that countries that appear to have moved to self-ID, sheets of flame don't seem to break out in all directions in terms of difficulties. Ireland is a jurisdiction which I'm able to have some view of, given that I have a friend or two who is an Irish lawyer. And it doesn't seem to have posed great difficulties since introduction in Ireland, as far as I can see. That sort of expresses my view about how it's likely to be in England, because trans people currently access single-sex spaces that conform with their gender identity. And absent the media's desire to pounce on any story they can find, once again, there doesn't seem to be a great difficulty in that use, and that use has been going on now for many, many years without difficulty. I don't see that, and many of those trans people don't have a GRC at the moment, as I don't, and I don't see, therefore, the change affecting the use of single-sex spaces in any significant way.
Thank you. Do you have? Are you able to comment on Section 22 in particular?
In what sense would you like a comment on Section 22?
Whether or not you think that the ability to withhold the fact that someone has a gender recognition certificate and it becomes protected information, do you think that that will be affected by the current legislation proposed?
It is likely. I mean, plainly, I would apply if I were a Scottish person and you would make the change which you're proposing. So I would then have the benefit of a certificate. But the number of times that I bump into officialdom with the need for that is relatively small. Yes, there would be some additional people who achieve that protection, but the extent to which it really affects their interaction with the world around them is, I think, relatively small. There's some protection against inappropriate actions by officialdom and an ability not to bump into someone who takes a prurient interest as to why one of your documents is different from another one of your documents. I'm a fairly upfront sort of person, so I tend to be able to deal with that circumstance fairly well. But many trans people have been through a traumatic life experience, and that degree of protection from proposals like... I mean, there's a proposal to make police forces record the sex of victims, for example, that's floating around at the moment. How can it be possibly relevant if you've been burgled that your legal sex is different from your gender identity? Now, having some protection via Section 22 obviously would be helpful in a circumstance like that.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Professor Sullivan, do you have any comment on that particular aspect?
Yeah, Section 22 is a really interesting example of the unintended consequences of the original legislation in 2004, because the privacy requirement was obviously meant to apply to this very small group of transsexual people who might not be obviously or openly trans. When we combine that with self-ID, it makes a lot less sense. But it was never, ever intended. And if you read the Hansard of the 2004 legislation passing through Parliament, never mentioned data collection, and it's very clear that, you know, this was about marriage. This legislation was about marriage and people being able to get married to who they wanted to get married to at a time when we hadn't yet passed the same-sex marriage legislation. And so many of these issues that we're considering now in terms of GRA reform just didn't come up in the discussions, and data collection is one issue that never came up. Now, for a long time, people were not collecting data on sex because they believed and had been advised that that would violate Section 22. Now, that has since been quite clarified, and it's clear that, in fact, it does not contravene Section 22 to collect data on sex. But we went through many years where we were losing data on sex, partly because people had misinterpreted the law. Now, I think as legislators, you've got to be really mindful of that. It's not just what your intended consequences are from this legislation. You've got to think really carefully about the unintended consequences.
Thank you, Professor Sullivan. Can I just check, did you say that Section 22 does not contravene, you wouldn't contravene Section 22 by collecting data on sex?
That's right, and that was clarified very strongly in the England and Wales census case, so that is now on record.
Thank you. And do you see any proposals in the current draft bill as it stands that would amend Section 22 in any way, or would that remain as you have just described?
I can't comment on the detail of the legislation.
Okay, that's a pity. Thank you.
Pam Gossel would like to come in briefly.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel, and thank you very much for your opening statements and the information you have provided. Just want to go on the back of what my colleague Pam has been talking about, single-sex bases. What are your thoughts on the system being open to abusers of basically bad faith actors who wish to gain access? And also, what are your thoughts on specific concerns for the women of faith? And I'd like to ask that question to Robin first.
OK, well, let's take that in two parts. Let's start with the bad faith actors. If I'm a bad faith actor and I want to access a woman's space, it's probably much easier to get a housecoat, a bucket and a mop than it is to go through the process of approaching officialdom and declaring yourself in some way to officialdom. So I have listened to the bad faith actor arguments, and they seem to me only weakly to be relevant to what's going to be done, because I can't imagine that any significant number of bad faith actors would find the current GRC process, or indeed an amended GRC process, a useful way to put them in a position to occupy their bad faith. There are much easier routes for them to do that. The second part of your question was about the effect on people of faith. There's a couple of things to say, but I think the first thing to say is that I assume that people of faith represent the general population, but that they have faith. That's the difference that they occupy. Now, we know that the general population are overall supportive of trans people and supportive of trans people's integration into society. I'm not a statistician, and I haven't spent time collecting the data, but I have friends and colleagues of many faiths who are supportive of trans people. So one has to be careful, I think, to say that what one's dealing with is a proportion of people of faith who have a difficulty with trans identities, or potentially with the effect of this bill. This bill doesn't change the protections that there are. It doesn't change the ability to exclude trans people in particular circumstances where there is a proportionate means of achieving legitimate aim. And it doesn't change the balance between one protected characteristic and another. So where there is a clash between people of faith and trans people, or take a parallel between people of faith and people of different sexualities, where there is an equivalent difference sometimes. Some people of faith are not supportive of people who live a lifestyle based on a different sexuality. The protections for those circumstances are in place and are not being changed by this bill.
Thank you, Robin. Going over to you, Professor Alice, just on that, do you know of anything happening anywhere else if there's data collected on this? Any bad faith actors, if things have happened anywhere else? And again, in relation to the question for women of faith, how the concerns obviously on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think the difficulty is that if we don't collect the data, then we don't know. And obviously, we've all read about instances, for example, in the NHS, where, you know, a woman's assaulted and then she's told, well, there was no male on this ward because they're not recorded as male. And so it becomes very difficult in data terms to actually to answer the questions. And that's really important. I just wanted to come back on something that Robin said about public opinion. I think Robin is absolutely right that public opinion is very supportive of trans rights in general. But of course, when you ask more specific questions, like should an intact male be allowed into women-only changing rooms, or should males be allowed into female sports, you get very different answers. So it's important to pay attention to the detail of that. Now, as far as women of faith go, I cannot speak for them. All I can say is it's really, really important that we hear their voices. And I think this is a set of voices that have been excluded. And that is, in general, women's voices have been silenced. That's true in academia, and I've written about that. So I can talk about that as, you know, I don't want to stray away from my expertise and into opinions, but I have talked about the issue of silencing. And that's something that I think should give the committee pause for thought, to be making legislation in a climate where people have been silenced in general for wanting to talk about sex and sex-based rights, and particular groups of women, women of faith, women of colour, are often particularly scared to speak out. And I've heard this from a number of people, because they're not only going to get the misogynistic abuse, they're also going to get racist abuse directed at them. And they're worried that it's going to be used against their communities if they do speak. So I would just say to the committee, please try to hear those voices, slow down, try to create an environment where you're actively seeking out those voices and trying to feed into a climate where there is a space for people to speak. Instead of, you know, sometimes we hear politicians saying quite incendiary things, and I think they need to stop and think about the consequences for silencing this discussion, which is never, you're never going to get good legislation coming out of that kind of chilling climate.
Just on that, Professor, just one last thing. So do you believe that it's very important that we collect data for this area so that we can see that nobody is excluded in any way through, whether it's through the health system or, you know, through basically any bad faith actors or women of faith, making sure that nobody is excluded from services or places? So therefore, do you think that data is very important to be collected?
Absolutely. More data is really important, and it's particularly important for monitoring equalities. And of course, that includes women of colour, women of faith.
Okay, thanks. Rachel Hamilton, please.
Okay, so I hope I'm not repeating myself, but it's a question for Professor Sullivan to start off with, please. Last week, or the week before, Dr. Guyon said that data collection activities such as the requirements for the public sector, equality duty, gender pay, reporting, crime and police records and census data follow a self-ID approach. However, as you said in your opening statement, senior quantitative social scientists have argued for the importance of retaining that data on sex. Can you comment on Dr. Guyon's specific comments and the conflicts that we see amongst academics?
Yes. Dr. Guyon is a research fellow in theatre, film and television studies. And I would say he's not part of the quantitative social science community. He doesn't have peer-reviewed publications using large-scale population data, for example. So he said that his views, that he hadn't met quantitative social scientists who disagree with him. Well, perhaps he isn't mixing so much with quantitative social scientists because he isn't one. He also referred in evidence to a letter regarding Scotland's census from 300 students and staff, largely based in North American universities. And he sort of made out that these are quantitative social scientists too. Well, actually, these individuals appear to work in a range of disciplines, including creative writing and theology. So that's not a letter from quantitative social scientists who use population data. It's a letter from activists who happen to be based in universities. And that letter actually accused advocates for the retention of sex in UK census data of taking an abominable moral position. And they likened this to slavery, eugenics, forced sterilization, and the denial of women's suffrage. So this kind of righteous zealotry, that's not how experts speak. It's a silencing technique, and it's been accompanied by a more general stifling of discussion of sex and gender, which I've talked about. Accurate data on sex is fundamental to any analysis of the differences between women and men, boys and girls. And this drive to undermine sex-based data collection has to be understood, I think, also as a form of silencing, designed to make certain facts unknowable and unspeakable. I'd also like to come back on Kevin Guyen's point about saying that everything is already always self-ID. And I think he was quite disingenuous there, because he tried to make out that because we ask people their sex, so it's self-reported, that therefore that's the same thing as gender self-ID. Well, that's not the case. We ask people, for example, to self-report their age, but we don't tell them that they can make up whatever age they like. We ask them for accurate data. So I just want to make that distinction. There is a difference between self-report and self-ID.
Okay, thank you for that answer. And I just wanted to ask you about your comments about Section 9 producing unintended consequences with regards to not collecting both gender and biological data. What did you mean specifically by that?
Specifically, you mean what in terms of which forms of data collection?
What did you mean? I'll say that again. What did you mean by the unintended consequences of not specifically collecting data by gender and sex within the bill, so within the Section 9, which you mentioned?
Right. So the unintended consequences, I think, is that you cement this reluctance to collect data on sex, which we're seeing across a whole range of areas. And administrative data is really important. It's not just important for effective administration. And I think people sometimes don't understand this, that people use administrative data for research. And particularly if we don't have another census, which is quite likely that we may not, then admin data will be filling that gap. And so it's hugely, hugely important for research. And we're already seeing problems in a range of areas. So in terms of the pay gap, we're seeing the Government Equalities Office guiding employers to exclude non-binary people from gender pay gap data. So not making this distinction between sex and gender. I mean, it's not plausible, or at least we can't test the hypothesis that being non-binary, that non-binary people aren't affected by their sex in terms of their pay, unless we have data on both their gender identity and their sex. In terms of health, you know, the NHS decides who to call for routine medical screenings based on the gender marker that they've recorded with your GP, and you can change that at request. And if you think about the effects for trans people, if they're not called in for screenings, because that's that gender marker that affects which screenings they're called in for, such as, you know, ovarian cancer, prostate cancer, cervical smears, and so on. And the consequences for them personally are potentially fatal. But there are also consequences for health research. With crime, we know that the situation is really patchy. So there's been FOI requests, and we know that different police services are, you know, some of them are recording crimes by male suspects as though they were committed by women if the perpetrator requests this, and that can lead to massive bias. So it makes it impossible to interpret trends over time in the data. For example, if you've got an apparent increase in females charged with rape, you don't know, is that because there have been genuinely more female accomplices charged, or is that due to an increase in males being recorded as females? And then, as I noted in my opening statement, the well-being of children transitioning at the GIDS service has not been followed up over time because their NHS number changes post-transition. And so that's another example where we can't actually evaluate these dramatic changes that are going on because we don't have the data.
Can I ask a similar question to Robin White? Now, Robin, I heard you talk about collecting data, sex data for burglary, for example. You used that example. I just wondered, on the basis that of what Professor Sullivan has said regarding the unintended consequences, whether there are other areas that you'd like to comment on of why maybe you differ in terms of the collection of data in its definition of sex and gender, but also could you comment on why it wouldn't be right for Police Scotland to collect data on sex when it comes to more serious crimes such as domestic violence, murder, rape, abuse and such other crimes?
Well, let's start with the example I gave, which is the current suggested guidance from the Home Office in London, which is to collect sex data on any crime. Now, if a trans person is living successfully in their affirmed gender, has done for many years, and they're burgled, why should they have to reveal their natal sex to a police officer? Why in any way is it relevant to that crime what their natal sex was? And I think the answer is no. And the unintended consequence may be that an individual is less likely to report crime, is less likely to be protected as they should be, if in that circumstance data is wholly unnecessarily collected. Or there's a balance, and there's always an incentive to collect data, more data, more data. But if there's a balance, taking my example, between the effect of chilling that person for reporting that crime and the state's need to know what the natal sex of someone who's burgled is, you will understand where I think the balance lies in that. Now, that may be different, and I acknowledge it may be different with different crimes, and I haven't analysed which crimes it makes a difference in. I think one of the pieces of advice we get under the General Data Protection Regulations these days is don't collect, for example, employee data unless you actually need it, because then you have to protect it and store it and look after it and do all sorts of things. And when I'm advising employers on data, then I advise only collect the data if you really need it, because then you don't have those other obligations. And I think unless there's a real purpose in collecting something related to crime, then it shouldn't be collected.
And can I ask one more question? Do you feel that we are ready for this reform when so many people are so concerned about the resource with the number of people who are self-identifying, as is stated in the CAS report, and seeking help from gender identification clinics? Do you think we're really ready for this without the resource that's able to provide the support to people?
I don't see the two things as linked in any way.
And can you explain that? Because I'm finding it actually really difficult to,
absolutely,
to understand that.
And it goes to the question that Ms. Chapman asked at the start in terms of, you know, what is the case for reform? We had the Gender Recognition Act in 2004, which is very medicalised. We then had the Equality Act in 2010 that took away the medical intervention that there had been in the 1999 regulations. And more recently, the ICD have reclassified, have taken away the pathology related to being trans. So the medical profession is saying that we are recognising trans as just part of life's rich tapestry in exactly the same way that homosexuality was regarded in a pathological way, and then we've come to realise that it's just how a proportion of people are. Now, that, in my respectful view, in a civilised society, we should be recognising, unless there's a very good reason not to, people's ability to define themselves in a way that they are comfortable with, unless there's a very good reason not to, and with appropriate exceptions and derogations from that. Now, the fact that they do that, is there any evidence that that will lead to, and I've been through a full gender reassignment process, so no one needs to explain to me how difficult and how enormous a change that is in life. And no one should go that through that process unless it's right for them. But the principal person deciding whether it's right for them is them. We live in a free society. People should make choices for themselves with every piece of proper advice and help that they should get, and either the state should give them or that they should obtain privately. But they should be free to be who they are.
I mean, I completely agree with that, but if we obviously that other people need to ask questions, so I shall move on.
Okay. Thanks very much. Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, convener. And thank you both for coming today and being witnesses for us. I would just like to ask, firstly, Professor Sullivan, in regards, you spoke earlier about health records. Are you saying that a GRC erases these? In what way would a GRC stop trans people accessing medical treatment and routine checks pertinent to their bodies?
So the point wasn't about GRCs specifically, but it was about the fact that people are able to change their NHS records on request. Now, that has, again, perhaps unintended consequences. People feel that they want to express their identity in their NHS record. And I think what we need to be explaining to people about data collection is this relates a bit to what Robin was saying earlier. Robin was taking the attitude, well, people have got their identities and they need to be able to express them. That's absolutely fine. But what we're interested in data is not making a judgment on people. It's just having accurate information. And so if you don't have accurate information on your health record, then that will have unintended consequences that you're not called in for screening that you should be called in for because your body is what it is. And then there's also implications for research where you've got, you know, people misclassified as the opposite sex, when actually that's reflecting their identity, which is different from their sex. So I think if we could just kind of explain to people, these are two different things, let's respect both of these things, then it could be a lot less adversarial and we could recognize both of these protective characteristics, rather than seeing gender identity as having to be in conflict with sex.
Very briefly, I'm in precisely that circumstance. So I'm a natal male who transitioned. So I still have a prostate, but I don't have a cervix. So I am on the register of people who are not called for cervical smears, as a number of women are, depending on what their life history is. No one needs to tell me what those differences are. I've had to work with those. And equally, I am on a register of people who are called for a prostate exam, even though my identity might suggest that I shouldn't do. The consequence is that when I visit my GP surgery or the new records person pulls my records or whatever, then there isn't... I am not outed in that way by that person seeing the records giving me an identity that is not mine. Now, there is a balance, and I absolutely accept Professor Sullivan is right to raise those difficulties. But frankly, trans people are very ready and able, as I have been, to deal with those differences where they impact on us and to speak in the privacy of my doctor's consulting room to make plain what needs to be made plain.
Thank you. So, Professor Sullivan, when it comes to NHS and, data and language around that, do you think that's where inclusive language and communication would be helpful so we're not being binary in these things? For example, my oldest son was asked if he could be pregnant when he went to get his COVID vaccinations. And these kinds of things, it's just one question, one answer, but there seems to be quite as you spoke about earlier, the discourse can be quite heated around this, whereas it's just one question and it includes everybody. Do you think that's helpful in regards to?
So I think clear communication and accurate communication are really important, and that's something that both data collection and medical communication have in common. It's really, really important that everybody understands what you're saying, and it's important that you don't ask questions that make people think that you're making fun of them, or that that make them think, what on earth is this person saying? So we've seen a lot of language which I think has been criticized as being both unclear and dehumanizing, particularly around women. And so, for example, there was a notorious issue of The Lancet where they talked about people with vaginas, and I'm sure you'd agree that, Karen, that that's not necessarily how we want to be referred to, people with vaginas. If you ask people things like, do you have a prostate, do you have a uterus, it's not the clearest communication. So I think whether we're collecting data or whether we're communicating with people in other ways, we just need to be clear and accurate and communicate with people that we're not making judgments about them. When we collect data, to come back to something Robin said, it should absolutely always be confidential. It's never about outing people. And I think if people understood that, the way that data is handled really, really carefully, then maybe that would give them some reassurance.
Yeah, I think, yeah, in terms of language, I think it has to be in context there, because I'm sure somebody wouldn't introduce, somebody as a person with a vagina unless it was in a medical or, pertinent context. So I think as well, ensuring that we keep this in the, in the context that it is, and it's not going to be used in the, wider aspect. I think that, it's not helpful for discourse. Robin, could I ask you, is there any other key aspects of the bill at the moment that you see is quite fraught with any difficulties legal wise or other?
No, I think I've expressed my view that it's a positive move forward to recognise citizens for who they are. I know there's been some comment about age, and I just wanted to make a comment about age because that is an area where you're widening the ability. And I was just looking last night at making sure that these are Scottish ages and not UK generally ages. But at 16, you can marry. You can be elected to a community council. At 17, you have to wait till 17 to give blood. The armed forces was interesting. The Navy will take you at 17, the RAF at 17 and 6 months, and the Army you have to wait until 17 and 9 months. Don't quite know why, but there you go. But you have to wait to 18 to be a member of the Scottish Parliament or a scrap merchant or to sell alcohol to the public. I'm sure those things are entirely unconnected. But what that illustrates, and I think, what is it? You have to be 35 to be President of the United States, don't you? Society makes choices. I mean, there is no line at which a child becomes an adult. I mean, you have your Age of Legal Capacity Act here in Scotland, as opposed to the Gillick competence that is used in England. And that sets a sort of presumption at about 16 for most things, as I understand it. So that's a choice that you make as a society, as to where you make that opportunity available to you. I knew as a young teenager who I was and what I was. And I know what choice I would have made had I been a teenager in Scotland today. And I'm 58, and I know that it would have been the right choice for me. Easy for me to look back on that, and I'm not saying that that would be the right choice for everyone, or everyone would have that same degree of certainty. But I... can I say what I think the right age is? No. Is it a choice that you as a society should be making? Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. And Maggie?
Thanks very much, Joe. I just want to come back in on a couple of things that you said, but before I do that, Robin, if I can come to you and just ask, you've spoken there about discussions around age, and you've spoken very, very clearly this morning already about self-identification and self-declaration. Can I ask you what your views are on whether there should be any, in your view, any sort of gatekeeping, whether that is medical, the gender recognition panel that currently exists that assesses dysphoria information and other evidence, whether you think we should completely disentangle this process from any kind of gatekeeping, or how you see that element of the bill working?
I don't see a purpose for the panel. I rely on my personal experience mostly, I suppose, in that I've known who I was since I was an early teenager. I don't need anybody to tell me that. Now, I've been through a full gender transition. It's a really, really serious process, and there is medical gatekeeping on that process, and rightly so, absolutely rightly so. You need to be very certain that you have the strength to go through that process. But does there need to be gatekeeping on declaring your identity? No, I don't think there does. Is it a serious thing? Yes. Should there be a formal declaration as the bill provides? Yes. Should there be consequences for making a false declaration? Not really for me to judge, but it should be a serious thing. And I think this bill would make it a serious thing. Do people need the 3-month waiting period? I don't know. Perhaps we can call in the services of Professor Sullivan, should you happen to enact this act, and do a study on who desists over 3 months. I suspect there'll be very few. And I wonder also if a person who has been living in an acquired gender for a long period of time, for example, needs a 3-month waiting period.
Okay, thank you for that. Professor Sullivan, Alice, if I can come back to you. You were talking earlier about medical records and the need to align medical checks, screening, that kind of thing, with the right bodies, essentially. And we then heard from Robin that actually the process of recording that information in the medical records can already happen, and actually the process for getting a gender recognition certificate has nothing to do with those records. So I'm just wondering why you think that is relevant if the bill we are looking at is about the process for getting a GRC rather than how medical records are recorded.
So medical screening occurs according to the gender marker in your records. And we know there have been cases of people not receiving appropriate screening because their gender marker is reflecting their gender identity and not their sex. I want to be really clear about, because I understand the concerns about confidentiality, but this data should absolutely always be confidential. And if people have concerns about that, then, you know, we need to be making sure that those concerns are addressed on the confidentiality in, you know, specifically, rather than any particular piece of data, because of course there's all sorts of stuff in your medical records that you wouldn't want all and sundry knowing, things that are actually far more sensitive than just your sex. So, and how it relates to the legislation, I mean, And just to say with sex, it is a systematic variable. It doesn't just affect, you know, it's not a cluster of bits and pieces where, you know, you just need to know about this organ or that organ. It's a systematic variable that affects every aspect of your health, and every cell in your body has a sex. So not just your prostate, not just your uterus, every cell in your body has a sex, and that means you can respond differently to different treatments. Of course, for some trans people, they will have undergone treatments which are also really important for their doctors to know.
Professor
but
Sullivan,
for some, they won't
if
have
I
done.
Can just interrupt you there, because that's not really the question I asked. The question I asked was about the process for getting a GRC, and because that's the bill we're considering. We're not considering how medical records are stored or are held or are used, or how different lists for different screening processes are managed. And given that there are trans people who do not have a GRC, who do and possibly do not get the medical treatment they require, why does changing the process for getting a GRC have the impact that you claim it does?
Yeah, so, and again, I want to come back to the unintended consequences of creating an environment where people find it very, very difficult to acknowledge sex. If it's very easy to replace your sex with your gender identity in law, then how is a service provider or a data controller going to turn around and say, oh, well, this is acknowledged legally, but we're not going to acknowledge it? I agree in principle they could, but I think you'd need to think very carefully about how you're going to make really, really clear not only that they can do that, but you actively want them to.
Okay. No, thanks. That's helpful. My last question to you, Alice, is you talked a moment ago about language being important and the use of language being important and needing to be clear and not dehumanising. I was struck by one of the comments you made earlier in relation to, I think it was a question in response to one of Rachel's questions on data collection and people answering questions, answering the sex question on a process of self-identification or self-declaration. Mm-hmm. And you likened it to the age question. And I think you said, we don't expect people to make up whatever age they like. Are you saying that people make up whatever gender they like?
No, I'm not saying they make up whatever gender they like. I'm saying they have their gender identity, which is very real. They're not making that up. But if we tell them to respond to a question on sex with their gender identity, then we're asking them to give the wrong information. And all I want to establish is that we should ask clearly about sex and ask clearly about gender identity and make sure that we understand both of those things, because both of those things are important to people's lives. Everyone has a sex. Some people have a gender identity, and the two may well intersect in people's lives. So we need to understand both. I didn't mean to imply that it's dishonest to answer a question in a way that you've actually been told to answer it, because of course it isn't. I think it's up to people collecting data to say, look, these are two separate things. We can collect data on both of them, and we can respect both of them. My worry is that by introducing gender self-identification, often what we're doing is actually erasing the category of sex. And that has particular implications for women and girls.
I'll leave it there.
Was there anybody else wanted to come in? Okay. Well, Alice and Robin, thanks to both of you so much. And we've gone slightly over time, but that's been really, really helpful to the committee in doing our deliberations. We'll now suspend maybe for about 5 minutes. Thank you. Welcome back. And I now welcome to the meeting our second panel. Joining us remotely, Victor Madrigal Borlaws, United Nations Independent Expert on Protection Against Violence and Discrimination Based on Sexual Orientation and Gender Identity at the Office of the United Nations High Commission for Human Rights. And in person, we're joined by Ian Duddy, the Chair, Barbara Bolton, Head of Legal and Policy, and Cathy Assant, Legal Officer of the Scottish, all of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. Particularly welcome Ian today, and I think his second day in post as the Chair of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. So you're all very, very welcome. But particularly Ian, we look forward to working with you on a range of issues going forward. So I'd like to invite witnesses to make a short opening statement, starting with Victor, please.
Good morning. I hope that you can hear me well. I speak to you from the Palais des Nations in Geneva, where last week I presented my report to the Human Rights Council for this cycle of the Council. As was said, I'm the independent expert of the United Nations dealing with violence and discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity, a mandate that was created in 2016 with the mission of bringing visibility to the way in which discrimination and violence manifest themselves against lesbian, trans, bisexual, gay, gender diverse persons around the globe. In this work of gathering evidence in relation to these manifestations of violence, I have paid particular attention to gender identity when it's at the root of discrimination and violence. And I have carried out inquiries in relation to the state of recognition of gender identity and expression in international human rights law, the requirements that stem from international human rights law as to the processes for legal recognition of gender identity, and finally, issues concerning good practices in relation to data gathering and management, amongst other things, crucial to the mandate that I discharge. In this work, I carried out an inquiry into gender-based frameworks last year, which was at the base of the reports that I presented to the United Nations Council and to the General Assembly of the United Nations, respectively entitled The Law of Inclusion and Narratives of Exclusion. These reports were an integral part of my research agenda under the United Nations Council resolutions that create my mandate and included an extensive literature review and a call for inputs in response to which 529 submissions were received, including 42 from member states and 484 from non-state stakeholders, including 202 from organizations and 282 from individuals. This process gathered specific information from all regions in the world, specific information from 88 United Nations member states, and I believe it covered a significant proportion of populations, cultures, legal traditions, and religions of the world. As a result of this work, I was able to arrive to three main conclusions. The first one is that legal recognition of gender identity is a key to ensuring the deconstruction of institutional and social drivers of discrimination and violence that affects so many persons around the world. The second one, that certain requirements are recommended and dictated by international human rights law in relation to the processes of legal recognition, including the fact that it should be accessible, that it should be fast, and that it should be widely available, along with other requirements that I'd be happy to elaborate upon. And finally, that gender identity is protected by a robust corpus juris under international human rights law as a trait protected from discrimination and violence. And to that, I go back to my first conclusion, that legal recognition is actually one of the fundamental elements that ensures the deconstruction of drivers of violence. I thank this Honourable Commission for having invited me to render testimony, and of course, very honoured and happy to continue the conversation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I hear from Ian Duddy, please?
Thank you for inviting the Scottish Human Rights Commission to provide evidence to the committee on this bill. My name is Ian Duddy. I'm the new chair of the commission, and I took up my post yesterday. I'd like to begin by providing a summary of the Commission's position regarding this bill. The Commission welcomes the changes to the process for securing legal recognition of gender identity set out in the Gender Recognition Reform Scotland Bill. In particular, three elements. One, the removal of the requirement for a diagnosis of gender dysphoria. Two, abolishing the gender recognition panel. And three, shortening the process. These three steps will move legal gender recognition in Scotland significantly closer to the standards set out in international law in this area. The Commission is Scotland's national human rights institution, or NHRI, accredited under the United Nations human rights system. And as such, the Commission acts as a bridge between international human rights law and the national system. And we promote full compliance with international and regional human rights standards. This Commission has a statutory duty to promote best practice in human rights. Therefore, the Commission's position on the bill is based not only on the European Convention on Human Rights, but also on wider international human rights law, guidance and best practice. It's the Commission's analysis that international standards and best practice require that the Gender Recognition Act 2004 be reformed to remove unnecessary barriers to the enjoyment of human rights for transgender people. At the European Convention level, gender identity engages the right to respect for private and family life. That's Article 8 of the Convention for trans people. The most basic convention requirement is that states must provide a process through which a person can change their legal gender. From that starting point, the European Court of Human Rights continues to recognise a broad spectrum of systems within the acceptable range, so-called margin of appreciation, including systems of self-identification and systems that require medical diagnosis. It is important to remember that the function of the Commission is to set a the function of the Convention is to set a floor, not a ceiling. What is clear from the European Court of Human Rights and the Council of Europe as a whole is that the system must be quick, transparent, and accessible. Looking beyond the European Convention, we can see from a range of sources that self-determination has emerged as the necessary human rights standard. We have set out those sources in our written evidence, but they can be found at the Council of Europe Parliamentary Assembly, the United Nations independent expert in this area, Victor is with us today, and the Yogyakarta Principles. The independent expert and Yogyakarta Principles both also highlight that the process must not require a medical diagnosis and ought to ensure that minors have access to the process. I'm sure both aspects will be discussed in more detail today. We have followed the evidence heard so far by the committee on this bill. We are very aware that some concerns have been articulated in relation to fulfilment of other human rights. The Commission's role covers the whole spectrum of rights for all people, and we take these very seriously. Having listened to the evidence and analysed any concerns raised through a human rights lens, we remain strongly of the view that the changes set out in this bill will bring Scotland closer to satisfying international legal standards and will not jeopardise the rights of others. My colleagues Barbara Bolton and Cathy Asante, lawyers within our legal and policy team, are here with me today and will be happy to answer any questions that the committee may have. Given that this is my second day in the role, I'd like to hand over to them for the substantive questions. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Ian. So we move then on to questions, starting with Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe, and good morning to the panel. Thank you all for joining us this morning. Thank you for the evidence you've provided us today, and also that the written evidence that I know the SHRC has submitted in writing prior to today. I've got a couple of questions for both SHRC and Victor for you as well. If I can come to you first, Victor, you spoke in your opening remarks about
the requirements for gender identification process to be accessible, fast and widely available. And you said that there were other requirements as well that you would be prepared to elaborate on. Could I ask you to elaborate on those requirements that you see as necessary and important if we are to get this process right? Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'm very glad that you asked that question. I was trying to be very obedient in the margin of the 3 minutes that I was allocated, but you've given me a wonderful point of entry and I thank you for that. Yes, the body of work that has been, that exists at the moment in international human rights law allows for the identification of six basic standards in relation to legal recognition. The first one is that it should be based on self-determination by the applicant. The second one is that it should be a simple administrative process. The third one, that it should be confidential. The fourth one, that it should be based solely on the free and informed consent of the applicant without requirements such as a medical and/or psychological or other certifications that could be unreasonable or pathologizing. It should also, as number five, acknowledge and recognize non-binary identities, such as gender identities that are neither man or women, and offer a multiplicity of gender marker options. And finally, it should be accessible, and to the extent possible, it should be cost-free. Each one of these criteria is examined by several bodies, global, many special procedures of the United Nations, treaty bodies, as well as European and inter-American regional human rights courts at analyzing the different bodies of law that they say their pronouncement on. And it derives from other processes, such as the declassification of gender dysphoria as a pathology effectuated in 2018 by the World Health Organization, and processes of evidence gathering that have led to the conclusion that medical and psychological and certifications oftentimes are indeed pathologizing, unreasonable, and in many countries around the world, still the source of significant instances of cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment and torture that includes sterilization, genital mutilation, and castration.
Thanks very much, Victor. That's really helpful. Can I just explore a little bit more in more detail around that, the connection or otherwise that you see with a medical or psychological assessment and obviously the removal of gender dysphoria as a pathology that you've highlighted. There's been discussion around whether there should be any gatekeeping or medical or psychological assessment at all as part of this process, and some witnesses that we have heard from have suggested that we retain some of that to ensure that the mechanism isn't open to abuse. Can you comment on that?
Of course, and I can comment on it from two points of view. The first one is the system to, as you say, how open is the gate and how much there is gatekeeping in relation to it. And I would also like to address the question of abuse, because of course, I know that this is one of the significant elements in discussions around this issue. In my report on legal recognition of gender identity, which I presented to the General Assembly of the organization in 2018, I took note of the release by the World Health Organization of the International Classification of Diseases, ICD-11. And this was considered by the World Health Assembly in May 2019. I correct myself, I'm sorry, it was in 2019, and this is the instrument of which I took note in my report. And trans categories in that report were removed from the mental and behavioral disorders, and a new category related to trans identities was created in a chapter called Conditions Related to Sexual Health. Now, the category of transsexualism was removed and replaced with a new category called Gender Incongruence of Adolescence and Adulthood. And now this was the, I would say, one of the milestones in a process of depathologization and led to the category not being defined in binary terms and does not actually relate to gender stereotypes. Applying after puberty begins and characterized by a marked and persistent incongruence between an individual's experienced gender and the assigned sex, leading to desires to transition in order to live and be accepted as persons of the experienced gender. And it then led to other considerations under ICD-11. This recategorization was intended to be used to facilitate access to gender-affirming treatment. And in other words, it meant that there is no reason to assign a diagnosis to trans people who do not seek gender-affirming medical treatment or some sort of bodily change. The mandate in this sense received constant information in all submissions to the effect that these changes were, of course, considered a major step in the respect of gender identity and gender diversity, and based on all evidence gathered by the mandate, this process of depathologization is also crucial in the promotion of deconstruction of social stigma around trans identities and non-binary identities. I therefore welcome that element of depathologization. And from that process of acknowledgement of the work of the World Health Organization, you will actually then know that clearly assigning the need for gatekeeping is one thing that this particular way of thinking would not require in order to ensure legal recognition of gender identity. Now, I believe that there are some countries in which it's still possible for a person to provide particular evidence of having undergone some sort of support, but this is not on the part of the requirements that are set by the state, but more part of processes that have been led in the past. The other element that I would like to address very quickly is the question of risk, which was addressed to throughout my work in this issue. And my suggested methodology for management in relation to these issues relates to the way in which human rights-based approaches internationally recommend the management of risk of abuse of any right, not only rights concerning to legal recognition of gender identity. And that's, of course, the implementation of risk management methodologies that include preventive measures, accountability measures, due investigation of abuse. And the reason why I believe that this is a relevant element in answering your kind question is that, of course, any right is always inherently accompanied by the possibility of abuse. And of course, acknowledging the evidence in relation to abuse to ensure duly preventive measures, for example, is part of a human rights-based approach. What is not part of a human rights-based approach is to withdraw the human right. I hope that I've answered your question.
Thank you very much, Victor. Yes, that does answer my question. If I can pose a similar question to the SHRC, we've heard a lot about the removal of the requirement or otherwise to remove the gender dysphoria diagnosis and the assessment panel, the gender reassignment panel. Can I ask you, and I don't know, Barbara, Cathy or Ian, which of you wants to take this one, but that element of risk management that Victor was talking about there, if we accept what I understand is your position that, yes, we do move to self-declaration, we remove the panel, we remove the need for gender dysphoria diagnosis. In the Scottish context, how can we best manage the risks of that Victor has identified around potential abuse and misunderstanding as well, perhaps, of what rights are actually being conferred here?
I think I'll start and Cathy can come in if I forget anything or miss anything important. Well, firstly, we would support everything that the independent expert has had to say, and we're very glad to be joining him on this panel today. What I would say more specifically in relation to the bill that's before the Scottish Parliament is the starting point is to very carefully assess what this bill is proposing, because we can't get to the risk and the assessment of risk unless we firstly are very clear as to what it does do and what it doesn't do. So
As we all know, this bill proposes changes for obtaining legal recognition of gender identity, which is a deeply personal matter of the individual. And in terms of its effect, obtaining a GRC affects highly personal aspects of life. Birth, death, marriage, obtaining benefits. What it does not do is affect the way an individual goes around their daily lives. So it doesn't affect accessing spaces, toilets, changing rooms, showers, gym classes, whether in school, at work, or out shopping. It also does not affect access to single-sex services or separate-sex services. It doesn't affect the protection a person has against discrimination on account of their gender identity or gender reassignment. They have that same protection whether they have a GRC or not, at work, in school, and in society at large. And I think that has to be our starting point, because once we've accepted that gender identity recognition legally is both a right in terms of somebody's right to private life and also a deeply personal matter, and that the impact is on very personal aspects of their life, in order to then put barriers up in relation to a person securing their legal recognition of their personal identity, we have to be able to justify those barriers. They have to be necessary. We have to show that there's a pressing need for that particular barrier. What is that barrier seeking to achieve? Does that particular barrier actually address the issue that's been identified? And then, is it a proportionate measure? Is it the least restrictive measure in terms of the rights of trans people in order to address that harm? Now, to apply that human rights test, what is absolutely critical is that we very clearly and concretely set out the specific harms that we're saying are going to occur. And what we need to look for in human rights terms is objectively evidenced, real and concrete harm that will arise from the specific provisions in this bill. So when we're talking about concerns, we have to be that concrete. If we're not that concrete, we can't go on to the next part of the test to find out what's a proportionate response, which is perhaps why we are in this discourse often going from very generalised concerns to the suggestion that the bill should not proceed. If you identify a very specific harm and you accept that it's objectively evidenced, so if this committee assesses all of the evidence that's put to it and concludes, actually, we think there is objective evidence of a real and concrete harm to specific people that will arise in relation to a specific provision in this bill, then the next step is to say, what is a proportionate response to that? And as I say, that has to be the least restrictive measure in terms, in this case, of advancing the rights of trans people that will address the specific harm that's been identified. And so we would encourage the committee to approach it in that way and to really consider whether a specific harm has been concretely set out, identified, and then are you able to move to that next step to apply a proportionality test to any measures applied. The Commission's position, as Ian outlined, is we have very carefully looked at this in two occasions now. We looked at this in 2019-2020, and taking our mandate very seriously, because we cover the rights of all people in Scotland, and we always approach human rights assessment recognising the interdependence of human rights. We take very, very seriously concerns that are raised about possible harmful effects on others, and in this case in particular women and girls. And we looked at that in 2019-2020, and we were not able to identify any objectively evidenced real and concrete harm that's likely to arise as a result of the reforms proposed. When the bill came around again, the Commission took a very conscious decision to look hard at this again, and that was in recognition of the time that had passed, the possibility that concerns had been clarified, that perhaps further evidence had been produced of real and concrete harm that might arise. And we made a very conscious decision internally to devote time to that, to really assess it. We did so, and we've concluded again that we cannot identify any objectively evidenced real and concrete harm that's likely to result from these reforms. Indeed, the majority, if not all, of the concerns that have been outlined do not appear to have a relationship with the proposals that are set out in this bill. That's our assessment, and that's why we continue to support the bill.
Thanks very much for that, Barbara. Just one follow-up on that. We heard in a previous session that, and I suppose this comes down to that question of harm and what has been described to us as competing rights of different groups. The questions, and I think in both introductory remarks, the notion of confidentiality and I suppose linked to privacy of trans people is important for us to keep in mind. When we heard previously that the right to privacy for trans people going through an accessible, non-invasive process would come with very serious consequences. Are you saying that those serious consequences as described are not, is your assessment that those serious consequences are not based in objective evidence at the moment, and your assessment indicates that actually there isn't the serious harm or serious consequences, there are no serious consequences that would arise if we were to pass this bill?
I think what I would say to that is that we find it very difficult to see how changing the process for obtaining gender recognition certificate is going to create issues in relation to those matters that have been highlighted: data, sport, access to toilets, access to changing rooms, gym classes, etc. Trans people already go about their daily lives on the basis of self-ID, and it's hard to imagine a society in which we respect the dignity and autonomy of other individuals, in which we could approach things differently. It's hard to imagine a society in which we would have a gatekeeping mechanism to check somebody's birth certificate before they can use a toilet or a gym class. Whether or not you have a gender recognition certificate doesn't affect any of those things, and we've heard very clear evidence about that through this committee's evidence taking. It doesn't affect your placement in prison. It doesn't determine your placement in prison, certainly. It doesn't determine whether you can have access to a particular sport. It doesn't determine whether you can have access to a particular bathroom. So this goes back to the point that the concerns that have been outlined, they're very generic, they haven't been made specific, but they also don't seem to have been tied to the specific changes proposed to be made here.
I'll leave it there.
I think Victor wants to come in briefly on that point.
Thank you very much. Just very briefly, taking due note of the exceptions that exist in the Scottish context, in which I will not expedite myself, I just wanted to share in relation to the question that argument of the alleged competition of rights was also something that was present in my inquiry through some submissions. And of course, I took it very seriously. And I reached a similar conclusion to that of the Human Rights Commission. The first thing is that it's not supported by evidence that there's any systemic identifiable pattern or risk in the very nature of the situation that is created by legal recognition based on self-identification. And second, there is already evidence of numerous states that have legal recognition based on self-identification, in which those theoretical concerns, and again, I'm speaking outside of the exceptions in Scotland, because I don't know those, Belgium, Denmark, Ireland, Luxembourg, Malta, Portugal, and Argentina are examples of states that have implemented systems based on self-identification and eliminated pathologizing requirements, and in which the numbers and the outcomes in terms of social inclusion and descent of violence against trans persons and non-binary persons are actually quite remarkable. Whereas, if so to speak, at the other end of the scope of worries, there has been no materialization of the concerns that were raised theoretically in the process of adoption of those processes.
Thank you. That's really clear. I'll leave it there.
Okay, thank you. Can I go to Pam Gossel, please?
Thank you, convener, and still good morning. Good morning, panel, and thank you for your opening statements and the evidence you've provided. I'm just going to dwell a little bit more into what my colleague Maggie's just talked about. Some of the opposition to the GRA reform has focused on the potential impact on women and girls, and particularly in relation to single-sex based services and exceptions in the Equality Act. The SHRC submission refers to the interdependence of human rights and states that the rights of women and trans individuals go hand in hand. Could you explain further what this means? And do you think it is possible that the GRA reform will cause conflict between the rights of trans individuals and any other groups, such as religious groups? And can I go to Ian first? And Barbara, obviously, you have touched on talking about that this reform, this bill, would not touch on.
It would either be Barbara or Cathy that are answering questions.
Oh, OK. That's right. OK. Could I have Barbara, please? Yeah, please.
Yes. I think it's probably important just to speak firstly to clarify the parameter of our mandate in relation to equality. So obviously we recognise and fully respect the role of EHRC as the regulator in relation to equalities law and enforcement in relation to discrimination. We've looked at the Equality Act in relation to this matter because it's necessary to take it into account in carrying out a full human rights analysis. Because the Equality Act provisions provide important mechanisms already under our national law in terms of how we apply that balancing mechanism. I don't necessarily think it's helpful to talk in terms of competing rights. I think it's perhaps better to talk in terms of tensions that can arise between certain rights, which can happen between in relation to a whole range of rights. Most rights, most civil and political rights certainly, are qualified. They're not absolute, and you have to apply a balancing mechanism in a range of settings to take into account the fact that we live in society and there are different rights at play in different settings. So we have looked at the Equalities Act, and we've noted that it provides very important coverage in relation to some of the concerns that have been raised. So, for example, the fact that it is possible to exclude trans people from single-sex spaces. It is possible to exclude a trans person from a single-sex accommodation, for example. And the test that's applied under the Equalities Act is very similar to the human rights law test, that you need to have a good reason, needs to be a legitimate aim. The measure applied needs to address that aim, and it needs to be proportionate. And it's for the service provider to decide if they're going to run their service in that way or not. But that possibility of where it's necessary and proportionate, excluding somebody on the basis that they're trans, is available whether the person has a GRC or not. So again, it's not affected by the changes that are proposed in this bill. It's not affected by the process for obtaining a gender recognition certificate. Similarly, reference has been made to Section 22 of the Gender Recognition Act, the fact that in recognition of the fact that gender identity is a deeply personal matter, and if somebody obtains a GRC, that likewise is deeply personal. There are provisions in the existing Gender Recognition Act to ensure that officials can only disclose the fact that somebody is trans or somebody has obtained a GRC or applied for one where necessary. And again, that's appropriate and would mirror a human rights approach that we respect somebody's privacy unless it's necessary to look behind that and see what actually does it say on their official documentation. So, for example, there's a specific exception in relation to the investigation and prevention of crime. And there's a specific exception in relation to offences, sexual offences, that can only be committed by people of a certain gender. And there's a specific exception in relation to disclosure to courts and tribunals. So, and we heard also from Rape Crisis Scotland that these exceptions are working in terms of their provision of services. They are They gave evidence that they would still be notified if somebody had a criminal record that was relevant to the provision of their services, whether they have a gender recognition certificate or not. So our analysis is that the Equalities Act already provides mechanisms for addressing any relevant concerns in a proportionate way. And that makes sense, of course, because the Gender Recognition Act came about in 2004, and the Equality Act came after that. So gender recognition certificates, the impact of gender recognition certificates was fully understood and taken into account in creating the Equality Act. And yet trans people's protection under gender reassignment does not turn on whether they have a GRC or not. So in our view, the two acts are working well together. What I would say on, because I think you mentioned EHRC's position, what I would say there is that, and this is on record, and we have said this publicly already, and we've said this directly to EHRC, we have not been able to identify an equalities law analysis that underpins their current position. And likewise, we've not been able to identify a human rights analysis that underpins their current position. So whereas they had set out in full a human rights and equalities law analysis that stood behind their support of this bill over a number of years, during which period they were advocating quite strongly for demedicalisation and the removal of the panel, their current position has been set out only in a handful of letters without any further more substantial documentation, reasoning, analysis. And we have asked them to provide further clarification because if you are looking at a piece of legislation that is proposing to further the rights of a marginalised group and you're in a human rights body and your position is that you oppose that legislation, then there is a considerable burden on you to set out very, very clearly on what basis that is. So I hope that explains where we're both coming from.
Just to come back in on that, convener, if it's okay. Mm-hmm. We've heard from many witnesses in this committee that they have a worry that this bill will exclude women and girls from minority groups accessing, single-sex services and spaces. What's your view on that, Barbara?
I think, Cathy, you were going to come in on that.
I'm not certain what the specific concern is there in relation to marginalised groups, specifically in single-sex spaces. Barbara's outlined the position generally on our view on single-sex space access. But I suppose in relation to, I know that there's been quite a lot of discussion around women of faith and perhaps difficult situations that they might be put in based on the tenets of their faith. And we did give some thought to whether that was related to the bill here and what the possible answers might be. Our view, building on what Barbara said, really is that it's not uncommon for there to be a balancing of rights that has to take place in relation to human rights in general. It's well known, it's built into the mechanisms of human rights law. And what is therefore required is an assessment of what the actual concrete harm or consideration is, and then a question of a proportionate response to that. So there's a lot of case law around balancing religious rights against freedom from discrimination, which would be the relevant right in relation to trans people. And what would need to be done is to create a policy that upholds the rights of both insofar as possible. So in that, in some of that case law, you have examples where people of the Christian faith are entitled to manifest their religion by wearing a cross because there's not a sufficient reason to prevent them from doing so, but they're not entitled to manifest that their religion in terms of discriminating against same-sex couples and providing counselling. So there's a lot of case law that explores that tension and shows ways to balance those rights. And I think the same thing would apply here. If we're talking about public services service providers like the NHS, for example, I would imagine that they have already been dealing with these issues for many years and that they would have policies designed to uphold people's rights, both the rights of both groups, insofar as they're able to do so. The key thing for us is that that is related to the design of policy that balances rights. It's not a consequence of this bill specifically. It's not specifically about the holding or not of gender recognition certificates. It's about the day-to-day reality of managing balancing of rights in the provision of public services.
Thank you, Cathy. Just on that, obviously, you know, Victor, many of you spoke about this bill will bring about, it'll be quick and, you know, it'll be widely available. So do you perceive anything in the future, it's kind of a futuristic question here, that any of these rippling effects that when you have more numbers coming through and it's easier to access, that it will have more effect on other groups, whether it's minority, religious groups or anything? Do you see, forecast anything coming up to see that this will open up more issues or people, you know, sounding off their concerns in relation to this bill?
I think that's a really important question, actually. And I think the key thing is that most of these concerns are not related to whether or not a person has a gender recognition certificate or not. So that's the thing that would be anticipated to change, is that more people would hold those certificates. But the areas of concern that have been raised are in almost no case determined by whether or not somebody holds a gender recognition certificate. So I don't see that there would be a significant impact in shifting that one legal criteria of the person's status, as opposed to questions that would arise from managing the presence of trans individuals in society in general. I think the accommodation of prisoners is a good example of this. I know there's been discussion about that as well, and any tensions that might arise. But if we look at both the Scottish policy and the English policy that have been discussed, individual risk assessment is actually the core of those policies. A gender recognition certificate plays some role, but is never determinative of the placement of a prisoner. So we heard from SPS that they didn't anticipate that there was going to be a major impact from the reform. So I think that gives us an example of, we're still going to have to deal with these situations. We've already been dealing with them for many years. There are policies that are designed to weigh into the balance different people's rights and to arrive at conclusions that uphold everyone's human rights. And it's not our forecast that that would be impacted by an increased number of people with gender recognition certificates.
Thank you, Cathy. Victor, do you have anything to say on this?
Thank you. Perhaps a couple of very quick points. The first one is that I'm very pleased to tell you that a colleague that I work very often and intensely with is the United Nations Special Rapporteur of Freedom of Religion and Belief, Dr. Ahmed Shahir of Essex University. And we have come to the conclusion in our joint studies and his reporting and thematic development that not only there is no real contradiction in human rights analysis of right to freedom of religion and belief and right to freedom from violence and discrimination based on gender identity, but rather there is an inextricable connection between the principles that found both respect for both rights. The Human Rights Commission has already mentioned the reality of the right to privacy as a guiding principle. And of course, that includes the protection of overreach by the state by arbitrary mechanisms that show no probing value, such as precisely the medical certifications that we have been talking about. And of course, pathologization in general. And we find a common thread of concern and a common thread of work in the idea that promoting freedom of individuals to determine the confines of their existence is very much a common trait of his concerns and my concern. Now, there's abundant jurisprudence and doctrine as to what are the limits and the scope of right to freedom of religion and belief, and the limits, of course, very much determined by the rights of others. But I just wanted to bring that perspective in human rights analysis. And the other thing that I was very much hoping to mention is that I believe that at the international analysis level, in international human rights law, the argument that is presented by the Scottish Human Rights Commission to the effect of the necessity to apply a non-discrimination methodology of analysis to measures to exclude persons from access is evidently what human rights-based approaches would also support. those steps that talk about necessity and proportionality and all other elements that Barbara has been mentioning is exactly the way international human rights law would look at this type of exclusions at the moment. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I go to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to all the panellists. Thank you for the questions you've answered so far, many of which I had on my list to ask, so I'll skip them. And also for the evidence that you've given in advance of the committee appearance this morning, it has been hugely, hugely helpful. I guess my first question to all of you is, how would you characterise Scotland's support or otherwise of LGBT people just now? And how would you characterise that might change if the proposed legislation was to go through? I maybe go first to Victor, if that's OK, and then to the SHRC.
I thank you very much for the question. I do have to say that characterising in general the situation of the treatment of LGBT persons, if I understood correctly, is that your question?
Yes.
I would respectfully have to decline to issue a comment in that connection, and I have two reasons for that. I hope that you will forgive me. The first one is that, of course, I'm not carrying out fact-finding in relation to the overall situation. I was very much asked to provide evidence in relation to this issue. But I also would like to mention to you that the other reason why I feel not entirely uncomfortable not answering your question is that it's been announced and confirmed that I will carry out a visit to the United Kingdom very soon, and I will be able to examine and have conversations about the general situation. So you will definitely be hearing from me in relation to that. The other element that I would like to say, however, because I am in a position to issue a statement in that connection, is that I've reviewed the proposed legislation, and to me, it actually takes steps to bring into conformity the process of legal recognition of gender identity with the international standards that I have identified through my research presented to the Human Rights Council. I have reviewed that legislation, and to me, those elements are taking this legislation closer to the fulfillment of that set of requirements that I mentioned. Thank you.
Thank you. Do you want to take it, Cathy? Thank you.
We haven't done comprehensive work on the state of LGBTQ plus rights specifically, and I think really we would defer to groups who represent those people to hear those experiences if we were to carry out that work. Certainly that would be the basis of our work. However, in terms of whether it would stand to improve in terms of this bill, I think all signs point to the fact that the experience would improve. We've heard from groups that have appeared before this committee about the impact of the current gender recognition process on their lives and their experience of their rights, which would be significantly remedied and improved by this new process. And also listening to Victor's comments this morning about countries that have brought in self-ID and the measurable impact on the enjoyment of rights for trans people, we can only anticipate that the same situation would occur here.
Thank you. Thank you both for your answers. And I want to move on to talk a little bit about what we've heard already, which is the interdependence of human rights. And I wonder perhaps if the SHRC could comment. We've heard from some people who've given evidence to this committee that there are women self-excluding from services, from public spaces, and from toilets, from changing rooms, and that self-exclusion itself is significant enough to be proportionate and to meet the test that you have set to determine that perhaps changes would be needed. Could you tell us about your understanding of that behaviour and how it relates to this particular piece of legislation? Because I very strongly take the point that we must refer specifically to the legislation in front of us as opposed to anything else.
Yeah, I can take that. I think it follows on from what I said earlier. I think, firstly, the Commission has not seen any objective evidence of these matters arising in society. However, if there is objective evidence that women are self-excluding from certain spaces, then you would have to look very closely at the specifics of that and what's resulting in that. If they're doing that, it's not going to be affected by whether or not somebody has a gender recognition certificate, because trans people exist in society and they move about society, and as is their right and as they must be supported to do. If there are specific concerns, so again, you would need to really break it down. So what is it that we're saying about toilets? What is it that we're saying about public life? What is it about? Because I have considered the question of women avoiding participating in public life and find it hard to see what it is about making gender recognition certificates available that would result in that. If the concern is about numbers in terms of, for example, women on public boards, if we try and get a bit more specific around that, if we're talking about a possible increase in the number of gender recognition certificates of 250 to 300, it's difficult to see how that's going to have a statistically significant or an impact in practice in terms of women on public boards. However, you could look at much more detailed analysis of that, and Professor Guyon recommended to the committee that they look at the written evidence from Close the Gap as an example of the analysis that can be done. They've run the figures in different ways, making different assumptions, moving some people self-identifying as a particular gender over to another gender and see how that plays out. You could do the same for women on public boards. When it comes to spaces like toilets and changing rooms, society has moved very far from what I still remember from many years ago, where you could go into a changing room and it was literally a room in which everyone changed. I have not seen that for many, many years. And I think we've moved very far towards finding a way of providing private spaces for every individual. And it's much more the default position now that you have cubicles. And you'd have to look again at the specifics, but if you have a reasonably spacious communal area plus individual cubicles, then it's difficult to see that there is a major issue. However, again, you would really have to get down to the specifics. But the further we do that, the further away we are from GRCs and what their actual impact is. And going back to what I said before, GRCs affect very deeply personal aspects of our private lives, marriage, death, birth, benefits. They don't affect how you move about society. And so, again, it's really important that we come back to that and that we look for a link between any specific concern that's highlighted and the proposals in this bill. And we are not able to identify that link.
Thank you.
If I could just add to that point, one of the things that we had recommended in our evidence is that there be a post-legislative review of this legislation if it is passed. And one of the functions of that would be to identify if any of these concerns have materialised or if evidence to support them has materialised. The fact that we have not found such evidence so far does not mean it doesn't or cannot exist. So we think that there would be an important role for a post-legislative review to do in considering whether any of these concerns are actually playing out, or whether it's more, as Victor said, that they have not actually have transpired. There are other important aspects that a review could accomplish in terms of identifying if there are remaining barriers for trans people or if recognition should be opened up to other groups, for example, non-binary people. But that's looking at any possible unintended consequences of the bill could be a really important role for that.
Thank you. And the point you make there on the impact on trans people, I think, is crucial in any post-legislative scrutiny and how trans people enjoy their human rights too. Thank you. That's really helpful. And I'm also particularly pleased to hear the focus on the bill and what it actually does as opposed to other areas. The I have a question also on your understanding. It kind of touches on the point that you made about representation, and I have seen Close the Gaps evidence, and I am convinced by it. But I'm just keen, for the record, if you could maybe set out your understanding of the recent legal cases on the census and the representation on public boards, please.
I'll answer that one.
Thank you.
So we understand that there's been concern that, the jurisprudence is continuing to evolve, and that the recent cases from the Court of Session, both the public boards case and the census case, are contradictory or confusing. I've looked at those cases in some detail, and what I've ascertained from them is that they were both looking at applying concepts of sex and gender in specific legal contexts. So one of them was applying the term sex in the question of the census, and in relation to public boards, it was about applying the category of women as opposed in terms of determining protected characteristics. What I believe they show is that the law already has sensitive and careful ways of applying concepts of sex and gender, and that where it is necessary for a person's trans status to be taken into account, as in the public boards case, then that is the law is capable of accommodating that and does do so. And where it's not relevant in the census case, then a person's trans status will not be taken into account by the law. Once again, neither of those cases were about whether or not a person held a gender recognition certificate. The court was very clear that that was not the determining factor in either conclusion that they arrived at. They were also very clear that there's no universal test or application of concepts of sex and gender. The point is that they have to be applied carefully so that we can ensure that they uphold everybody's rights.
Thank you. That's helpful. Thank you. I just have one final question, if that's okay, Convener.
Well, Karen, first of all, it's a different question. We'll come back to you if that's all right, yeah?
Yep, that's fine.
Karen.
Thank you, and welcome to the panel today. I'd like to ask, in regards to the EHRC and the SHRC, has there been any agreement in regards to respective mandates? And looking at this through the in terms of the Scottish perspective, and are there any differences in approach to gender recognition, and if there are, why?
Yeah, I can cover that. I think I touched on it already earlier, but just to clarify, EHRC is the equalities regulator for the whole of Britain, and that's a factor that relates to the devolved structure, where equalities law is generally reserved to the UK Parliament, and EHRC is the regulator for England, Wales and Scotland. Its mandate in relation to human rights in Scotland is restricted, and that's set out in its legislation. It's basically precluded from doing any work in relation to human rights on devolved areas, unless it seeks and receives consent from the Scottish Human Rights Commission. And that can happen, particularly if there's an area where the Scottish Commission is not able to perform work for reasons of capacity and focus on other issues. And there is a memorandum of understanding in place between the commissions that gives further specification to how that process is put into practice. The Commission's mandate is very broadly covering all human rights and all devolved areas, so it would include this bill. In terms of the position on this legislation, as I mentioned, EHRC was in favour of it, was promoting it until very recently. Their position changed, and their position's on record. It's available in letters with, I think, the Cabinet Secretary, and they've referenced concerns that, again, are framed in very broad terms that refer to areas that are familiar from the evidence that's been put to the committee, and we've asked for further specification because without that specification it's very difficult to really understand their change of position from being in favour of this legislation and highlighting the real need to demedicalise, depathologise, the real need for this bill to advance the rights of trans people, to change to a position whereby they're saying no, we shouldn't go ahead with this and we need to wait and see. Wait and see isn't an appropriate human rights response, as Victor mentioned. There is the human rights framework that you would apply to assess any policy or legal development, and that's what we've fully set out in our submission.
Okay, thank you. And so in regards to that, the bill provides that only those born in Scotland or ordinarily resident in Scotland may apply for the GRC. And there's been some concern that this might mean that trans people from the rest of the UK will travel to Scotland, particularly young people who maybe don't have supportive families. Can you explain any views that you have on this requirement for ordinarily resident?
Yes, certainly. Ordinarily resident is a term that's used in various areas of the law. The Commission's view is that it's sufficiently specific to rule out what's been referenced as a concern. So if you are resident ordinarily here, that would rule out somebody coming for a weekend or for a longer holiday or, you know, for a temporary stay purely to obtain a GRC. It simply wouldn't cover that. However, we've heard and we agree with the points that were made by Just Right Scotland in relation to the need to make it sufficiently clear to avoid inadvertently excluding people who you're intending to include. So by using the term ordinarily resident without further detail, are we seeking to cover or not those who do not have citizenship but are located here in Scotland? So they haven't chosen to reside here, and perhaps we wouldn't even use the word reside, but they are located here while they're awaiting the outcome of an official process. So if we are intending that they should have access to this process, which we would hope they would, then it would be good to see some clarity around that.
That's really helpful. Thank you. Victor, would you like to come in on any of those questions?
Thank you very much. Perhaps just to underline that the concept that has just been explained from the domestic point of view is very consistent with what human rights frameworks would actually prescribe. Persons under the jurisdiction of is, you know, the human rights language for the enjoyment of rights. And of course, there's always a certain margin as to what exactly that entails in relation to occasional visitors. And of course, as was mentioned, but I think the point being made about those persons that may not have residence but are expecting or waiting for the outcome of processes is particularly relevant given the connection with access to a number of realms of life and legal recognition. But I think that it's absolutely consistent with a human rights framework analysis. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Camilla.
Thank you. And Rachel Hamilton.
Cathy, can you tell me how you pronounce your surname?
It's Asante.
Asante. Okay, so I wanted to address you by your full name. So Cathy Asante mentioned that the SHRC recommends post-legislative review following the reform. However, the Children's Commissioner expressed a different view and expressed concern that more research is needed to ensure that safeguards are in place before the age is reduced from 18 to 16, suggesting that pre-legislative evidence should be taken in more seriousness by the Scottish Government before we make significant changes within this Parliament. Can you comment on his view and why, and explain your reasoning why you support lowering the minimum age? That could be for Barbara or Ian as well.
Okay. We have had discussions with the Children's Commissioner in relation to this bill. My understanding of his evidence was that he was supporting the lowered age limit to 16, but the committee can correct me if I'm incorrect. But
and then within evidence suggested that more research needs to be done by the Scottish Government.
One of the areas that of his analysis touched on the possible need for additional support for 16 to 18-year-olds, for clarity on what questions might be asked of them to establish capacity and what support would surround that process. We support that call to seek clarity on those particular areas, and that was my understanding of the position that he offered. But in order to explain our own position in relation to under-18s, looking to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, one of its core approaches is to recognise the evolving capacities of children and to balance that up with providing them with protection where that is needed. I noted that the Children's Commissioner did highlight that minimum age requirements require more scrutiny where they are acting to curb children's freedoms, as opposed to serving a protective function, so a protective function like in the justice system. Excluding young people from access to gender recognition procedures would be a curb to their right to private and family life, so we would not be in favour of imposing unnecessary minimum age requirements. We also find that the age of 16 is in line with Scots law in terms of the Age of Legal Capacity Scotland Act, which permits young people to enter into very significant legal transactions. And so if this bill was to lower the age to 16, it would be in line with existing Scots law that permits children to make decisions of that nature. And additionally, the international human rights standards have pointed out that minors should have access to legal gender recognition processes, and the age in and of itself should not be a barrier. So the key aspect there would be about recognising the evolving capacities of children and ensuring that there is sufficient support for them in order to be able to exercise those as they grow older.
OK, just to follow up.
Rachel, I think it's probably useful for the record just to clarify that Cathy's interpretation of what the Children's Commissioner we've checked said, and that's correct, he was talking in relation to support for young people. Rachel.
Yeah, and that's relevant to the committee's evidence gathering. On particularly, you mentioned there the Age of Legal Capacity Scotland Act, which was 1991. On that basis, when that was in 1991, a long time has passed since then. Can you explain what you mean by evolving capacities of children?
So the evolving capacities approach is recognition of the fact that as children grow older and become young people and move towards adulthood, they gain greater autonomy and evolve a greater capacity to understand the nature of important decisions in their lives and to make decisions in relation to them. And it recognises also that children develop at different rates. So at certain stages, you may wish to apply a presumption that if a person reaches a certain age, then they would have capacity to do a certain thing. That's what the Age of Legal Capacity Scotland Act does. And at other stages, there may be a need for some assessment or support of their capacity before you're able to say that they have capacity to do a certain thing. So there are examples in the Age of Legal Capacity Act again, where children between the ages of 12 and 16 can be assessed as having capacity to make significant decisions, such as medical treatment, and then would be given the legal authority to make that decision. That's what I mean by the evolving capacities approach.
Okay. I'm not sure what that's based on, whether it's puberty or whether it's other capacities, social capacities, but it's something that this committee could possibly look at. I was going to ask you, I've asked everybody this, it's about the CAS review. Obviously, there's a lot more young people accessing services, gender identity services in England. And I just wondered whether you believe that our reforms should be paused to take into account of the full report being published rather than just the interim report.
I can answer that. The short answer is that we don't think that this legislation should be paused in relation to the CAS review. But just to explain that position a little bit, the CAS review, as we understand it, is looking at reviewing gender identity healthcare for children and young people in England. And they've made some interim findings on data, which we understand to be relevant to the provision of gender identity healthcare. It's not clear to us how that relates to this bill and the provisions in this bill. What is, I think, clear is that although it's about England specifically, when the full report's issued, it will be important for relevant bodies in Scotland to review it and see if there's relevant information there that can be applied here. There may well be useful learning in relation to the provision of medical services. There may well be things that prompt Scottish bodies to conduct their own review to understand the position in relation to healthcare provision to children and young people. What we did hear very clearly from the evidence of the National Gender Identity Clinical Network for Scotland is that whether or not somebody has a gender recognition certificate is not determinative of access to gender identity health services. They treat everybody as though they had a GRC, which seems appropriate. They said it's absolutely relevant and important, but it does not change the direction of their clinical care. So whether or not we enable greater access to gender recognition, whether or not we have that additional estimated 250 to 300 GRCs, is not going to have an impact on healthcare delivery. And if we do as this bill proposes to do...
Just in terms of, we know that waiting times are up to 2 to 4 years. I'm just wondering how that doesn't impact on how, you know, the healthcare provision doesn't impact with a greater number of people wanting to access services in terms of their human rights, and you know, it's enshrined in law in the health service in Scotland in terms of a waiting times guarantee. Does that not apply to people seeking transitioning?
So absolutely, there's real concern there around the waiting times. And it's when we listened to the evidence from David Parker about 4,000 people waiting for that initial appointment, and about people waiting in Grampian 15 to 18 months and 3 to 4 years in Central Belt, that's very concerning. And it raises concerns about the right to health. And those issues must be looked at. But that is not affected by whether or not you have a gender recognition certificate. So a young person seeking gender-related healthcare is entitled to seek that healthcare whether they have a GRC or not. And David Parker gave very clear evidence that whether or not they have a GRC doesn't affect whether they're provided with care, and it doesn't affect the direction of their care. So again...
Is the CAS review in that sense relevant when young people from Scotland access healthcare in England because they can't get access in Scotland?
I'm not aware of the CASH review having said that whether you have a GRC in England is determinative of your healthcare in England. So I don't see that connection again to this bill. What I would say about cross-border impacts is that, again, going back to what a GRC does and does not do, and because you have the same protection under gender reassignment characteristic, whether you have a GRC or not, somebody going from Scotland to England is going to have the same protections in relation to their gender reassignment in school, in work, in medical context, as they would whether they have a GRC or not. So again, these concerns that have been mentioned about people travelling from Scotland to England, again, we really need that to be spelled out. And much more specifically, what is it about the provisions of this bill? What is it about making it less intrusive, burdensome and pathologising to trans people that would have these particular impacts? And again, we're just not seeing that.
OK. Have you got time for a quick question?
Yeah, we've got a couple more questions to come in.
I just want to go back to something earlier that we were discussing. And obviously, had a consultation and 59% of people spoke about this bill opposed the principles of the bill. It was quite a considerable number. But through a human rights lens, if this act was reformed, on the Equality Act, do you think that for women who are concerned about safeguards and the opt-outs on a single-sex basis, do you think that the exemptions as described by Amnesty should be justified on the basis of less stringent criteria. They didn't say that. They said, so I'll get this right for the convener. They said, Amnesty said that it must be justified on the basis of, they are justified on the basis of quite stringent criteria. So therefore, do you think from a human rights angle in terms of women's views of safeguards and opt-outs, that that should actually be made simpler in law so that the exemptions are there and those women feel protected for the reasons that we're hearing?
So I'd like to just break that question up if I can. So the first thing I think you referenced was the percentage of support for the bill in response to one of the consultations. I think the easy read version of this committee's consultation. What I would say to that is obviously where society is at in terms of its support for a certain measure is always going to be a relevant factor to take into account. However, when you're approaching something from a human rights basis, what you're not doing is applying majoritarianism. What you're not doing is saying it is the majority in favour of this measure. What you're doing is you're saying, what are the fundamental rights of everyone? What are the inalienable rights that were set out following in the fallout from the Second World War and the horrors of that, and the international community coming together and identifying some of the fundamental rights that belong to everyone? And those rights stand regardless of the views of the majority, and indeed they stand against the views of the majority in some cases, because if you had the majority that wished to override the fundamental rights of some, those rights still exist and those people are still entitled to those rights. I'm not suggesting that's what's happening here, but I'm countering the idea that that this is a question of numbers, because fundamental rights are never a question of numbers, and perhaps Victor would have more to add to that. It might be useful. But I would also want to address the single-sex space reference. I'm not sure exactly which part of Amnesty's evidence that was. I did listen to their evidence, and I think that we were in agreement. I think their evidence accords with ours. They may have used slightly different language. If the reference to stringent criteria was perhaps another way of describing the human rights test that I've set out, that where you have a bill like this that proposes to advance the rights of a particular marginalised group, and address the harms that are currently that currently exist under existing legislation, you need to have objective evidence of a real and concrete harm that will occur to others before you would, in order to then look again or be required to look again. So perhaps that's what they were addressing. I think there was a third part, but I you might have to remind me.
Well, it was just my take on this. It's just with regards to... I mean, obviously, everyone has a human right, and everyone has concerns. Whether they're, bettering trans rights or they're protecting women's rights. It's just that's how it is, and that's how we're hearing it in this committee. I wondered whether the exemption set out in the Equality Act should be looked at in terms of how we're evolving as a society in terms of the different asks of people. Law needs to move on as well, and I wondered if you had an opinion on that as well.
I think it's always useful to review legislation, especially after a number of years. However, I think we have to be very careful again to be specific, given that what we're talking about here is essential measures to further fulfil the rights of a marginalised group. If we're looking at the Equality Act and we're saying that we have concerns about the way certain exemptions or specifics apply, we need to be very particular about what we mean, which provision, in what context, what's not working. And our assessment is that the exemptions that are available do appear to work, and the evidence that's been given to this committee has shown that they work in prisons, in single-sex services, in special services for those who've suffered violence and gender-based violence. And what we haven't heard is evidence that they're not working. So, in principle, of course, it's always good to check that your legislation is still...
I'm going to leave it there, but unfortunately, there are people who are self-excluding because they don't want to come out and actually say what they're experiencing, so they don't access services because of their fears or concerns, and that's just one side of the argument.
But I would just come back quickly on that to remind the committee of the Rape Crisis Scotland evidence, which is that they've been running a trans-inclusive service for 15 years and they do not believe that people are self-excluding.
Thanks for that. And Victor, we'd like to come in on a few of the points that Rachel's discussed. So, Victor.
Thank you very much to the convener. And I'll be brief, but I wanted to make sure that I touched upon a couple of things. Mention has been made of trans rights. There are not such a thing as trans rights. There's not such a thing as gay rights. There's not such a thing as lesbian rights. There are human rights of people who are gay, human rights of people who are lesbian, and human rights of people who are trans. And what this means is that the analysis that has been presented by the Scottish Human Rights Commission, which is the limitation of these rights, of these human rights, is actually subject to a series of requirements that are very much part of the regulatory framework applicable to Scotland, as in many other countries in the world. Let me give you an example. The Convention on the Rights of the Child, Article 5, makes reference to the evolving capacities of the child. It says that state parties shall respect responsibilities and rights and duties of parents or, where applicable, members of extended family or community, as provided by local custom, legal guardians, or other persons legally responsible, to provide in a manner consistent with the evolving capacities of the child appropriate direction and guidance in the exercise of the right of the child recognized by the Convention. And the second reference to this is, of course, in Article 14 of the Convention, where the same concept of evolving capacities of the child is articulated. Now, the concept of evolving capacities of the child is actually the very much the consequence that children are recognized as subjects in the decision of the exercise of the rights. And it is a principle stemming from the Convention of the Rights of the Child, ratified by the United Kingdom in 1991. These principles allow for the recognition that children in different environments and cultures and faced with diverse experiences will acquire competencies at different ages, and action is needed in law, policy, and practice so that the contributions children make and the capacities that they hold are acknowledged. And I think the colleagues at the Scottish Human Rights Commission have explained the way in which public policy is being articulated in the specific Scottish context as to how this actually relates to public policy frameworks in Scotland, recognizing how age intersects with other elements in the identity. Now, finally, I just wanted to mention and to bring into evidence that legal recognition at 16-year-old, it has already been implemented by several countries, that is the Netherlands, Ireland, and Belgium. Norway has also under 18 legal recognition with a parent of guardian, and Luxembourg and Argentina are currently identifying similar legislation. Finally, in relation to impact of legal recognition of gender identity, I just wanted to share with you some recent evidence that has been provided to my mandate on the impact of inclusive legal recognition that follows the requirements that I spoke about. It's evidence stemming from Argentina and New Zealand, two other countries that have adopted legal recognition on the basis of self-identification. A survey carried out by similar parameters in national level in both countries revealed in Argentina a drop from 80% reported exclusion and discrimination from health, employment, and housing sectors, from 80% self-reported instances to 30% 2 years after the issuance of the law. And as I said, these are contexts, both Argentina and New Zealand, in which no evidence has been produced about the materialization of risks that may have been articulated before as part of the discussion on the basis of views which were hypothetical and not supported by evidence. Thank you very much, Mr. Convener.
Thank you. If we can now go to Fulton McGregor, please.
Thank you, Convener. And my apologies to yourself and to all present. I've been late today. I was impacted by the rail strikes, as I'm sure that the convener has reflected already. I'm going to ask questions around the three-month the provisions in the bill around the three-month period for reflection and the three-month period for living in the acquired gender, as it's referred to. And what I would just say at the outset is apologies if it is an area that any of the panellists have already covered, because although I have had access to the session remotely, you'll understand, in quite a lengthy journey, which was this morning, there were certain periods where it wasn't possible to pay quite as much attention. So on the three months living in the acquired gender, perhaps yourself, Barbara Bolton, have you got any thoughts on that? We've heard quite widespread criticism of this from, if you like to call it, but both sides of the argument. Have you got any thoughts yourself on where the committee might want to take this particular provision in the bill?
Yes, I do. Thank you for that. The Commission's view on this is that it's not been made very clear in the policy memorandum accompanying the bill what the purpose of this is, why it's necessary or proportionate. It seems from looking at this generally that there has been an effort to shorten the process, a recognition that 2 years is far too long, and a desire to create a more reasonable expectation. However, from the Commission's view, applying a human rights analysis, that doesn't approach it in quite the right way. So to go back to what I said earlier, which you won't have heard, if we are accepting that this is about the fundamental rights of trans people and that they need to have legal recognition of their gender and that GRCs affect very intimate parts of their personal lives, marriage, death, birth, benefits, then any barrier that's put up in relation to their access to that legal recognition needs to be on a basis that it is necessary to achieve a legitimate aim and a proportionate measure to do that. So the question arises, why is there a requirement to demonstrate you've been living in a gender for 3 months? And we don't feel that that has been adequately explained or reasoned. And obviously the three-month period creates a delay, which trans people have explained their concerns around that. And if we, some of the evidence focused on that period of life where somebody is perhaps moving, taking up a position in a college or university or moving for work, and they wish to have their documentation match up, 3 months would be potentially quite a significant period of delay in relation to that. But our concern also is that it's about this requirement to produce some evidence that you've been living in a certain way. And it's difficult to see how we can require somebody to produce evidence that they've been living in a certain gender without supporting very harmful gender stereotypes. How do you demonstrate that you've been living as a woman? How do you demonstrate that you've been living as a man? And I find it difficult to think of a way that you would do that without supporting and upholding what have been found to be very harmful stereotypes affecting women and girls as they affect others. So we have real concerns about that, and we would invite the committee to really press Scottish Government in proposing this bill that they look again at that provision. We're concerned that the bill has a provision that seems to invite the registrar to provide more detail on what's required from trans people in terms of evidence. That raises the prospect that we may replace the panel with another burdensome bureaucratic process where trans people find themselves in correspondence with a third party being assessed against something that is deeply personal to them. And I think if you're introducing any element of third-party assessment about somebody's very personal gender identity, there really has to be a good justification for that, and we're not sure what that is. I have thoughts also on the 3 months reflection period. If
Well, just to say thank you for that, and I had heard your earlier comment, but I think it's particularly important to get on record your concerns as you've laid them out there. And I was just going to come straight to you before going over to Victor and asking about the 3 month reflection period as well. So if you're best placed to answer that, that's fine. But I was also going to give both Ian and Cathy a chance to come in. But if you're best placed to talk about the 3 month reflection, that's fine.
Yeah, Cathy and I have been sharing out addressing the questions. This is one of mine. I think, again, the 3 month reflection period, just to look at how that works, as we understand it, that's a further delay in somebody securing a gender recognition certificate. So instead of applying and receiving as administratively possible or in the time that's possible, there's a requirement that you wait 3 months. And at the end of that 3 months, that you reaffirm your request to obtain a GRC. So it's a further burden on trans people. And again, we think there needs to be a very clear justification for that. What is the legitimate aim there? What's the purpose of that requirement? And we've heard reference to, including, I think, from the registrar, that they may introduce a process whereby people are alerted or signposted to relevant, helpful support. Now, that sounds appropriate and useful if it's done well. However, it's not clear that that would necessitate a 3 month delay. And I also wonder if it was deemed to be necessary to achieve some aim, if it might be more proportionate that at the end of the 3 months, the trans person applying, if they wished to withdraw their application, they could do so within that time, but that there wouldn't be a burden on them to essentially reapply or reaffirm their application. So again, we think there needs to be a bit more thought given to what exactly is the purpose of that, why is it necessary, will it achieve the aim, and is it proportionate?
Thanks very much. Maybe just one final question. I know that the convener said we're tight for time, but have you got some thoughts on the term acquired gender? That's something that, as you've heard in previous sessions, there's been quite a lot of discussion around.
Yes, we've heard some concerns about that, and we would, well, firstly, we would generally defer to trans people to as to how problematic that term is for them. I think, though, we would also look at the term potentially differently if it's being used more specifically or not. So looking at the Gender Recognition Act, we think that the main intention of the use of that acquired gender term is to describe acquiring legal recognition of the gender. However, and in relation to that, we can see there needs to be a word to make the legislation work. And so that maybe is why it's required. However, it's also being used in relation to as more of a general description of the experience of trans people. And that's where we think it may be particularly problematic, because good evidence has been given about the individual experience of people, and that the suggestion that people acquire a gender in terms of their own experience is a poor reflection of what most people actually experience. So if it's specifically on the legal point, and if it can be limited to that, we can see why it might be necessary. But if perhaps more care can be taken around how it's used, and if we get rid of the three-month requirement, a chunk of the problematic area is kind of removed, because what you then are talking about in the amended Act, which is what will result from this bill for Scotland, will be more specifically about that acquiring of your legal recognition of your gender.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Victor, I'm wondering if you would be able to comment on any of these areas of the bill, either the three-month reflection period or the living in the acquired gender for 3 months, as it's currently written.
In relation to the expression acquired gender, I share the point of view of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. I think that if it's an enabling term to ensure that legislation can actually function, that actually works. But if it's meant to refer to the lived experience of trans persons, I think that the evidence that has been presented to me over time is that this way of describing the deeply felt gender identity of persons is probably something that is more conducive to perpetuating stigma and their own self-perceptions as minimized. The three-month reflection period, this is something that makes me think of a number of mechanisms that have been put in place all over the world and that appear to answer to the notion that this is something where the person has something to prove beyond what the legislation has established as a necessary and reasonable requirement. And I would place this in the number of requirements that would seem ab initio, neutral, but that in fact, when confronted with the way that they interact with the lived experience of persons, can actually present significant hindrance. So I could note that, for example, a recent concluding observations on Australia, the Human Rights Committee noted that delays associated with a process of authorization that was required for hormone treatment and expressed concern that the success of treatment could be compromised because of time. And I have received significant inputs on the fact that it is often the case that procedures take years to be completed, and that long waiting lists oftentimes contribute to several of the exclusion problems that people face. So I actually think that the question would be, what is the a reflection period meant to do? Is this person meant to prove something that is beyond what is reasonable in the context? Then again, why 3 months? And then again, why not, as was so eloquently expressed by one of the previous speakers in the previous panel, recognize the fact that persons have the ability to know how they have felt as long as they have lived, and therefore that there is no need to actually interact in a way that is abusive of their privacy and their convictions. Thank you.
Palmer, still want back in? Or is...
No, actually, I think it's been covered. Thank you.
Okay. Well, thanks to you all. That's been, again, really, really helpful. So we'll now suspend again for, I think, 5 minutes before we get the next panel. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Okay, welcome back. So I now welcome to the meeting our third panel. So pleased to welcome Dr. Sandra Duffy, lecturer in law, and Dr. Peter June, senior lecturer, University of Bristol School of Law, and Dr. Chris Dietz, lecturer in law and social justice, University of Leeds. Apologies for any surnames that I've mispronounced. Can I ask witnesses to make short opening statements, starting with Dr. Duffy, please?
Thank you. Committee members, thank you so much for the opportunity to appear here today. I'll be brief. I'm an international human rights law scholar specialising in gender identity and the law. And on that basis, I fully recommend a self-identification basis for the Gender Recognition Act reform. I've worked on global and regional gender recognition law mapping and analysis. I co-wrote three editions of the ILGA World Trans Legal Mapping Report, and most recently I have completed an analysis of gender recognition laws in Europe to be published next year. The international movement in gender recognition law is toward depathologisation and self-identification. A non-medical, non-judicial, purely administrative approach is the only approach endorsed by the United Nations independent expert on sexual orientation and gender identity in his recent reports. Legal gender recognition should be accessible, affordable, and depathologised. Legal gender recognition on the basis of self-identification has already been enacted in countries as diverse as Malta, Denmark, Argentina, and my own home jurisdiction of Ireland. Although highly polarised concerns have been aired in the United Kingdom around the possibility of allowing for self-identification, they have not played out in those countries. There has not been widespread abuse of the process or an unexpectedly large number of applications. There has not been widespread reports of abusive use of the process by cisgender men to access women's spaces such as changing rooms or bathrooms. There has not been a sea change in the number of cisgender women selected for sports teams. Trans people know their own minds. They do not take the decision to transition, be it legally, socially or medically, lightly. Young trans people too can be trusted to make their own decisions, especially if supported by their families. It is unfair to make them choose between pathologising their nature and respect for their autonomy. The law needs to respect the human rights to dignity, equality, privacy and autonomy. Scotland needs to respect its trans citizens. And on that basis, I recommend that the committee considers self-identification as the best option for legislation. Thank you.
Thank you. And Dr. June?
So, hello, my name is Peter Dunn. I'm a senior lecturer at the University of Bristol and an associate member of Garden Court Chambers. My research focuses on the intersections of law, gender and sexuality, a particular focus on issues of family law and European law. In recent years, I've had the opportunity to work with a number of public institutions like the Scottish Government, the UK Government, the European Commission and the Council of Europe. I'm particularly interested in looking at questions of law from a comparative perspective, and it's that angle that I'm probably going to contribute to today's conversations. I started working on questions of legal gender recognition about 10 years ago, and in those 10 years there's been some welcome progress. Laws which more respect people's lived experiences across Europe. And we've also seen across Europe as well a greater understanding of the reasons why people seek to obtain legal gender recognition. There has been some less welcome developments. There has been legal stagnation, even legal retreat. And there has been, at times in public policy debates across Europe, a failure to remember the humanity and the dignity of the people who these laws affect. In addition to the specific questions that I'm sure we're going to discuss today, I want to, or I suppose I come to this conversation from maybe three broad outlines. The first is to acknowledge that this is an area of immense complexity and nuance. Legal gender recognition cannot and should not be reduced to pithy quotes of 290 characters. It requires you to engage with, to acknowledge, and indeed to embrace that nuance and that complexity. Secondly, unfortunately, because of the historic invisibility of trans and non-binary communities across Europe, there isn't perhaps as much hard law as we might like or expect. But as Dr. Duffy has already said, and I know as you've already heard in prior committee meetings, there is a strong body of regional and international consensus around soft law standards and best practices. And I'd encourage you to allow those standards to both inform and to shape your discussions. And finally, from my own research, what I would say is that when we look at those jurisdictions around Europe, which today we hold up as models of good practice, yes, they have shaped their legislative debates by looking to their international human rights law considerations and the existing domestic rights standards which exist. But they've also done so by considering the lived experience of people in their society. The laws which you are considering today, which I fully support in terms of the draft bill, are going to affect people, many people in this jurisdiction. And I would encourage you to remember their lives, their experiences, as you consider this bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. And Dr. Dietz.
Hi. Thank you first for inviting me to the panel. I'm Chris Dietz. I'm a socio-legal scholar, again, of law, gender and sexuality, and based at the School of Law in the University of Leeds. I'm a cisgender man, so I would also emphasise, you know, the experiences of trans people being taken into account. And I'm just going to try and stick to, rather than focusing on those experiences, which aren't mine, the research that I conducted on the adoption of self-declaration of legal gender in Denmark in 2014, which I wrote my PhD on and also have been publishing on the findings of since then. Denmark became the first European jurisdiction to implement self-declaration in 2014, which was timely for me as I was conducting my PhD at the time. I travelled to Denmark on various occasions, but conducted most of my research over the course of 3 months in the spring of 2015, interviewing trans people and non-binary people, but also campaigners and officials who were involved in the legislative process there. At the time then, it looked possible, or just after that, that England and Wales would follow Denmark, but various shifts have seen, political shifts have made that not possible. And it's quite exciting that Scotland is going to go ahead, or trying to go ahead, with reforming the Gender Recognition Act. To sort of quickly summarise my findings from my research in Denmark, it's that self-declaration is no panacea. So on its own, it has limited effects. And I've been sitting in this morning and hearing that that's kind of well understood by the committee now, that just making it possible for people to access a gender recognition certificate doesn't change wholesale sort of trans people's legal inclusion. However, that can constitute an important first step in the right direction towards improving the everyday lives of trans and gender diverse people. I'll leave it there for now. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. And you've all put the pronunciation of your names on the record properly. I'm going to stick with first names of going forward on this session. So thanks. We'll move to questions. I'm starting with Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe. I'll stick with first names too. Thank you all three for coming along this afternoon and for giving your opening statements. It's been helpful to hear your opening statements in relation to some of the other things we've heard both today and prior to today. I wonder if I can ask a couple of questions around the case for change and some of the requirements that we would be removing from the gender recognition process if we pass the bill as it is, the requirements around medical and psychological diagnosis and that the panel of experts being an important assessment or gatekeeping role. Sandra, you talked about the polarised concerns that we experience in the UK not being manifested elsewhere. Can you maybe say a little bit more about how the case that we are hearing, the case for reform that we are hearing in Scotland particularly, how it was different elsewhere, and I suppose where then the catalyst for reform came from elsewhere, if it wasn't born out of the same kind of debate that we might be having here.
Absolutely. So just to clarify what I was saying, it's not that concerns have not been raised in other jurisdictions, and it's not that legislative debate has not happened fully in other jurisdictions. And the one I can speak to most fully is Ireland, as obviously it's my own jurisdiction and it's one I've conducted some of my research, including my doctoral research, on. In Ireland, and as Peter has actually already said as well, these debates are happening. They are fully nuanced. They are taking place in legislative chambers. They are taking place in the public eye as well. And they were at the time of the passage of the Gender Recognition Act. So there is, although the atmosphere in the UK at the moment is very polarised in terms of this, it's not that there hasn't been debate, and it's not that there hasn't been robust public debate in other jurisdictions. It's just that those jurisdictions have come to the conclusion that reform, or indeed legislation, new legislation, is the way forward. The case for reform, basically, from my point of view as a human rights scholar, comes out of an understanding of the basic human rights of the individual. So the case for removing a pathologised requirement, a diagnosis, or be it medical or psychological, the case for removing a judicial process, such as an expert panel, from the process, comes from that understanding of the autonomy and the equality of the individual, that the individual should not have to, and I'm borrowing and slightly adapting some logic from the European Court of Human Rights here, but that the individual should not have to choose between their autonomy and respect for their identity. As my colleague reminded me earlier, and I'm just saying that, that's from a European Court of Human Rights case called AP Garçon & Nicot, which was the one that removed sterilisation as a requirement for legal gender recognition in France. But as Dr. Dunn would tell me, that was meant to be a floor, not a ceiling. So I think I can use the logic when it comes to depathologisation.
That's helpful. So in your view, the depathologisation is actually an integral part of the reform, the bill that we see in front of us, that we are scrutinising?
In my view, yes. Yeah. It's very important.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks for that. Peter, if I can come to you. You talked about the need to and the importance of mixing international good practice and the human rights standards with personal the lived experience of trans people and those who are going to be most affected by this. We've heard in different evidence sessions around the potential for conflict or competition of views around who will actually be most affected. And I suppose in your comparative analyses, how have you drawn out any conflicts or competitive notions of impact to come to the view that you have for reform?
Well, what I suppose I would say is that so what we when we look at the reasons in a comparative context, particularly in Europe, why jurisdictions have adopted reform and why jurisdictions have adopted reforms which are similar or identical to the reforms that you're advocating or you're proposing, the Scottish Parliament at least is proposing and you're adjudicating upon, we can see a couple of reasons why that was, and then we can see how issues of conflicts of rights have played out. So I think it's fair to say that jurisdictions like Denmark, like Malta, like Ireland, like Norway, have absolutely been conscious not just of emerging standards within the Council of Europe, so things like the Parliamentary Assembly or the High Commissioner for Human Rights, who have advocated for a significant period of time now that the existing structures within human rights law require or compel us to remove a diagnosis requirement. We also see in these jurisdictions they've just taken evidence, as you were doing, evidence from people who are talking about how the diagnosis doesn't work. And I think that's really important. You know, I did work in 2018 for the European Union, and I was involved in a second project in 2020 which looked at legal gender recognition laws across the European Union. And there was no common reason across
all jurisdictions why people advocated for the removal of a diagnosis requirement. But there were some which we could pick out as themes and which I think are really important. So lack of accessibility, right? The problem that people couldn't access the diagnosis requirements that they were, that was necessary to get. And that's, of course, something that you have already heard about here. Issues about contraindications and diagnosis. So medical complications across Europe which prevent people from being able to access a diagnosis of gender dysphoria. Also something we've seen within the UK context. The symbolism of not being the person who is able to advocate your gender, right? The indignity of having to go to a third party and to say, actually, you need to tell me who I am. If you look at international SOLF law, at least one of the common themes you can see is people saying, listen, even if we don't agree there needs to be self-ID, we do need that the process needs to be quick, transparent and accessible. And the diagnosis requirement has been considered both across Europe and across the European Union and the Council of Europe as being a major obstacle to that question of quick and transparency. It creates a huge amount of time. I think what we have seen is it's very much true that if you look in jurisdictions like Spain, if you look in jurisdictions even like outside of Europe, like New Zealand, the processes towards self-determination have been in some ways delayed because of greater consultation around around potential conflicts of rights. What I think is interesting in a number of jurisdictions is that having gone through that process, like for example they did in New Zealand, like having gone through that process like they are going through in Spain, they still passed the self-identification law in New Zealand. They're still proposing to pass that self-identification law in Spain. I suppose one thing that I would say, and sorry, I realise I'm taking up a lot of time, so I will stop talking, is just considering some differences between the debates. And one I think which is really important is that when we talk about the policy debate in not just the United Kingdom, but specifically here in Scotland, very often the difference between the debate that we're having around gender, around self-ID in this jurisdiction and elsewhere, is that actually it often seems like under the guise of opposition to self-ID, we are actually seeing policy debates which are really contrary to the Gender Recognition Act itself. And that is not similar to the type of public or policy conversation that we've seen in jurisdictions like Ireland and in Denmark, and even in places like Germany or Spain. That's more analogous to the type of anti-gender analysis and arguments and conversations we see happening, for example, in Hungary, where they have recently repealed their gender recognition laws, and around the decision of the highest courts in Bulgaria, where they've taken a very regressive step back. So I would just be careful about this. We need to focus on self-ID, not on the GRA. Okay. Sorry for quite a long answer.
No, that distinction at the end there is really, really helpful. Chris, can I come to you with your detailed analysis and knowledge of the Denmark situation? It's been suggested that your research finds that there's a desire in Denmark to make the access to the medical treatment pathways self-declared as well. Can you say a little bit more about that and what, from your analysis, from your research, what is your position on the kind of medical gatekeeping around, I suppose, the different stages of transition that people might go through?
Okay, yeah, thanks for your question. That's not quite the point that I'm making in my research, okay, actually, in relation to the point I've made previously in a published article in Feminist Legal Studies was more to do with the fact that, which was kind of specific to the Danish case, which was that provision of healthcare had been accessible or more accessible in the private healthcare sector in Denmark than in the public healthcare sector. And around the time they enacted self-declaration, they also closed down some of the private provision of healthcare, which was based on a kind of informed consent or shared decision-making model, which I know in a previous evidence session David Parker mentioned is at least the aspiration of Scottish healthcare for trans people. I also heard about the wait times and things. These are also, you know, making things inaccessible for people and plenty of room for improvement. And actually, out of the trans people I interviewed, I mean, some of them may well favour treatment on demand based on their own self-declared gender, but a lot of them were mainly arguing for a movement back towards this kind of shared decision-making informed consent model. Briefly, well, actually for several years, there was only one hospital after the legislation passed where you could get a transsexualism diagnosis, which was the diagnosis they were using in Denmark. People talked about a state monopoly, basically, at this clinic where it was slightly more old-fashioned in its kind of approach towards trans issues. So I think that was quite specific to Denmark and maybe wouldn't be so applicable in Scotland. The point that, you know, when people have access to different kinds of protections, whether that is or different types of recognition, whether that's in the healthcare system, protections in employment and access to housing, these kind of material issues, the point that when people get a gender recognition certificate, that their experience of everyday life will be improved if they have the access to those other things as well, I think stands in a Scottish context as well. But I wouldn't say that there would be any kind of negative reason not to make the reforms as proposed here based on the Danish case, as, like I say, said before, an important first step towards kind of improving trans people's everyday lives.
Okay, thank you. If I can just explore a little bit further with you the sort of depathologizing then in the, and I appreciate the context of private versus state healthcare in Denmark is different, and we have the issues around waiting times and that we have well explored. The trans people that you interviewed, that you've spoken to, that depathologizing, that was, did that come across as a really significant shift for them, for their own experiences?
So yes and no. So yes, in the terms of the legal change, yeah. And for the people who had accessed healthcare and were, you know, kind of had reached levels of support in different areas, for them, the fact that they could easily change their legal documentation without going through what was previously kind of a sterilisation process in Denmark was huge.
Okay.
For the people who were struggling to, who maybe had their healthcare taken away, basically, that mm-hmm. some of the private healthcare providers that they were going to had been shut down and maybe they'd been rejected or just couldn't go back to the state healthcare system. The question of depathologization was a bit more muddy, but I think purely within a legal frame, taking a diagnosis like gender dysphoria out of legislation would make a significant impact on people, at least on a symbolic level, for, you know, their inclusion.
Okay, great, thanks. And I suppose being mindful of an earlier comment about what the reform we are scrutinising seeks to do and what it doesn't do, I think that your comments are well made. Thank you.
Thank you. And can we go to Rachel, please?
Just a quick question. I just wondered, for your experience, international experience of looking at different models in terms of, obviously, jurisdictions across the world are very different. And I just wondered, can you talk us through how you see the differences between Scotland and other jurisdictions. For example, you've stated some countries that now have self-ID, but in some of those countries, medical documentation might be required to be produced. So, I mean, we don't have a standardised approach. It's kind of, how can we learn from this? And no one country has one standardised approach, do they? So the question is really, can you talk us through where all these differences lie, and which is your favoured country that has taken the approach that you agree with? And on what principle has that been established?
Thank you. That's a very interesting and quite a broad question, so I'll try it's good. It gives us an avenue to explore, I think, so it's good to have. You're absolutely correct that there is no one standardised approach. There are basic minimum human rights standards that we need to follow according to our international obligations. Okay, so things like the removal of sterilisation as a legal requirement for legal gender recognition was done by the European Court of Human Rights and therefore applies to the nation states of the Council of Europe. Things like the introduction of legal gender recognition as a human right under Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights after the Goodwin case, again, is a basic human rights standard now that we have. So what I would say when it comes to different approaches from different countries. In countries where there is self-identification, medical documents do not need to be produced. Okay, so that's a standard. Self-identification works on the autonomy of the person themselves, as opposed to the authority of doctors or judges. I personally find the Maltese system to be a high standard for human rights. I think the Danish system, which obviously Dr. Dietz can give more detail on, is a good system. I think Iceland has recently adopted a very good gender recognition law based on self-identification, with provisions, I believe, for some minors with parental support, and also for non-binary recognition, which obviously isn't a reform we're discussing today, but is something that has come up in quite a few jurisdictions. As regards to sort of more... I guess at this point they are older legislations, but such as the Irish Gender Recognition Act 2015, I think the process was, as I've said before, it went through robust legislative debate, but I think the process that came out was quite simple, where it is, there's a payment of a nominal fee, and the applicant makes a declaration to the Registrar General in Ireland to have their legal gender updated. And I think that is probably the most human rights compliant system. I think self-declaration in general is the most human rights compliant system, with that depathologization that my colleagues have discussed as well.
Dr. Duffy, just on the... Thank you for that, by the way. On the requirement for documentation in other countries like Croatia, Finland, Germany, why did they come to that decision rather than the examples that you've given where no medical documentation is required?
Why, again, is quite a big question. It would have been through the legislative process, taking evidence, I suppose, as you're doing here in Parliament and in hearings. There is currently, although it is accepted as a human rights standard, that depathologization is the kind of the gold standard for legal gender recognition, there is currently no legal requirement to depathologize one's legislation. So if elements, I believe, in the Parliament, in the legislative debate, came to the conclusion to keep medical documentation as part of their legislation, that is, of course, the right of the country to do. However, I would submit that it is far more in tune with human rights standards and with the development, I suppose, of the discourse in human rights law around gender identity to depathologize and to remove the judicial and medical requirements from the process.
Peter.
Yeah, so I suppose when we think about the development of these laws, right, we think about the first law being developed in Sweden in 1972. And I think what you have to really understand is the legislative context, right? The legislative context, I suppose we would say, it was very much one which was inherently linked into a medical context, right? So our only understanding of trans identities was one through a medical lens. And that extended in the Council of Europe well into the 1990s, indeed, to the 20th century. So you talk about Finland. Finland, as far as I'm aware, adopted its law in 2002, where this notion of a trans identity being inherently medicalised would have still pervaded a lot of the kind of the legislative understanding. So you ask, why did they adopt this medicalised model? Well, it was because that was what was the standard of the day, right? When many of these jurisdictions, like Germany or Italy, adopted their original laws, that was the understanding. I think what's really important in that context is we look at what's happened post-Goodwin, what's happened post-Argentina adopting a law in 2012, right? And if we look at the majority of jurisdictions across Europe that have changed their laws more recently, they have opted for that non-medicalised standard because our understanding as a society has changed and our understanding of the human rights norms has changed. I would say that if you look at kind of Why are there? Of course, are differences, right? Because there's a common law jurisdictions, there are Roman law jurisdictions, civil law jurisdictions, there are mixed law jurisdictions like Scotland, right? And so how the law plays out is going to be different in all of those countries. I think what I would say is when we're thinking about medicalisation, we have seen some jurisdictions which have specifically put into their law that this process is not going to be medicalised. So the really good example is Malta, which really makes that strong affirmative statement. And that's not something that you have to put in. But of course, I think as somebody who's conscious of human rights standards, it might be something. I think what's really interesting with your point is we can see some differences right around different self-determination models. So Malta, for example, has this waiting period that you are thinking about adopting, and maybe we'll talk about it later. I think that's human rights compliant, and to the extent that I don't think there is any rule of international human rights law that says you can't have it. I would say, what is it doing, right? So is it just an arbitrary waiting period? Is it actually serving some purpose? And if not, and whatever. I think the key issue is around young people. And maybe if somebody has a question about young people, I'm happy to leave it there and we can consider the differences. Yeah, cool. Perfect.
I don't know if anyone else has got the age question. But it came up in the last panel,
yeah,
in terms of evolving capacity.
Was that you, Karen?
Not specifically, but I could ask that. Yeah, I was going to come in and sweep up any questions that hadn't been asked. Yeah.
I will also say I'm conscious that I just spoke for a bit.
Can I just go to Chris on my question, please, before we come in about age?
Yeah, so just briefly, I mean, in Denmark, I think the government that came into power in 2011 was part of their coalition agreement that they would look at how gender was registered by the state, and from the people who were involved in the government and also some of the campaigners who were involved in lobbying, the discussion of why they became the first European country to adopt self-declaration was mainly that they thought that was the direction that things were going, and in time I think they've been proven to be correct, actually, in terms of if you look at all the other jurisdictions around Europe and elsewhere that have followed this route that originally Argentina was the first one that it went down. And also this sense that they wanted to, yeah, make sure that it was fireproof in terms of human rights standards later. They didn't want to enact something which would then fall below European human rights standards, international human rights standards. So they went, you know, with the, because there was a proposal in the consultation stage of lots of different models, and they just went with self-declaration because they thought it was the most accessible, and the best in terms of human rights, and also some other things. I mean, to consider, I suppose, things like that it was cheap and easy to implement. That when you don't have a lot of bodies and organisations and panels and things, that yeah, it just makes it. The responsibility of the individual.
The Scottish Human Rights Commission this morning suggested that we should have a post-legislative review. Does that happen in... is there any international comparisons that have done that?
Yes, in Ireland, 3 years after the Gender Recognition Act was brought in. So in 2018, they conducted a review, which included legislative scrutiny, committee hearings and public consultation.
Okay, thanks.
And that worked actually quite well in Ireland, and actually was then placed in, as far as I'm aware, into the 29 the subsequent legislation on abortion.
Yeah.
So it was deemed to have worked well as a process, and therefore was deemed to be an appropriate process for the abortion legislation.
Okay, so we've touched on the waiting time, so I'm actually going to go to Fulton McGregor, who I think wants to probe a little bit more on that. I think Peter started answering the question that maybe Fulton wants to cover, so we'll go there.
Thanks, convener, and good afternoon now to the panel. Thanks very much for your input so far. Yeah, I'm going to ask the questions that I asked of the previous panel and in previous weeks, the line of questioning, and if you manage to see any of the previous panel, you'll know what that's about. It's about the provisions in the bill to live in the acquired gender, as it's termed, for 3 months, and also the 3 month reflection period. So I wanted to ask your views on that. So starting on the 3 months prior, have you got any views on that, and do you have any views on the term acquired gender? This is an area where we've heard quite widespread criticism of this particular provision. Perhaps that with yourself, Dr. Duffy.
Okay. So, two parts to the question, I suppose. The term acquired gender, to start off with. Personally, when writing about this form of legislation, I tend to use true gender or lived gender as opposed to acquired, to represent that trans people do not suddenly acquire a new identity, that they have actually always had that identity. They just may not have been living out in the particular identity. So I tend not to use the term acquired, and I think my colleagues would probably agree on that. With regard, I suppose, to waiting periods, my own personal opinion is that they don't seem to serve much of a purpose. As Dr. Dunn pointed out in his previous answer, and I'm sure we'll pick up on this as well, the question is why a waiting period? So why are we introducing that term, that aspect of temporality into these legislations? Why do we require permanence? Why do we require waiting periods? I suppose the answer that's given is legal stability, and that. But if legal gender recognition, as is envisioned by this bill, otherwise is an administrative process, is a depathologized process, is something that, then I don't see why a waiting period is a necessary addition to the bill. I would also say that the current Gender Recognition Act 2004 standards for a 2-year waiting period is very much out of line with international standards on the issue. I think if I might hand over to Peter to come in on that.
I don't have much. Oh, go ahead. No, please go ahead.
I think you were maybe just about to go with my point there. I was going to say, if you've not got anything else to add to that, is it be something new?
Substantively would add much to it.
Okay, so on the thanks very much for that. So on the 3-month reflection period, perhaps if I can ask about that, and I might start the reverse way this time, just in case the same happens again. And sorry, Dr. Lund, you're in the middle. So, Dr. Dites, have you got any thought on the 3-month reflection period?
So in Denmark, they had a 6-month reflection period, which works, I think, similarly to how it's proposed in the bill. So a person would make an application and then have to confirm that themselves. And if they didn't confirm that, you know, the application would fall away. The trans people that I interviewed, the people who had applied or would consider applying for recognition, found that a little bit patronising and, yeah, again, weren't sure what they were supposed to be reflecting on. Based on this understanding that, you know, when you go to apply for legal gender recognition, in a lot of cases it will be towards many years into reflecting on your gender and gender identity. In terms of the authorities that I interviewed, that there were some kind of practical reasons. In Denmark, you can change your gender back if you realise that, you know, it wasn't the right thing for you. And so I think the reflection period they put in as a kind of to stop people, you know, doing that constantly. I don't know if that would be a significant consideration in Scotland or not, but yeah.
Thanks for that. Martha Dunn, have you got any thoughts on that?
No, I think what I would say is that I don't think there's any prohibition on the implementation of one of those periods, right? So I don't think, you know, for example, the European Convention on Human Rights, it's certainly not a violation of Article 8. We haven't seen anyone try and bring a case to or make that argument in Denmark. I think what I would say is that I do think, when we think about international soft law norms, there might be a significant number of actors within the system, within the both the Council of Europe system and within the UN human rights system, that say that it is not necessary, or who might say that it's not compatible with that idea of self-identification, and potentially raises questions for the sort of speed and the length of the process. What I would sort of say is very much what you've said, is that when there was a sort of a Europe-wide survey in 2019 and 2020, there was an acknowledgement that these periods did exist. But there wasn't a huge amount of consideration of it within the survey results. Some people, I think, said it might have been a bit excessive, but it wasn't one of the major concerns that I think people were talking about in terms of accessing legal gender recognition.
Thanks. Dr.
Just to add very briefly to that, as I mentioned in my opening statement, trans people know their own minds. So this is not something that people come to lightly. This is not something, as Dr. Dietz said, this is something that people think about for many years often before they enter the legal process. And what we're trying to do here, and what I believe most of the reforms that are put forward in this bill are aimed at doing is returning the agency to trans people, returning the agency and the autonomy over their own legal status to trans people. And it seems to be an interposition of yet another standard of authority if we impose a waiting period on them as well. That we're saying that you don't know your own mind, you need to think about it for another 3 months. And I don't find that that is in keeping with the spirit of some of the other reforms that have been proposed. So personally, I would recommend against implementing a waiting period.
Okay, thanks very much, Sam.
Okay, thanks. So we'll pick up Karen in terms of the area that we started talking about. So if you want to go and come.
Yeah, so I was going to ask a question. It's quite general. So if you want to come in there with the age and answer about that, that's perfectly fine. It's, you know, in terms of this proposed bill that's before us at this time, the purpose of the bill is to make life that bit fairer and more dignified for trans people, to acknowledge their human rights and put that into legislation. So with that in mind, looking at the key aspects of the bill, are there any parts of that that you feel could be improved upon to meet that goal?
I think...
Could start with...
Okay. I think I'm going to give the floor to Peter just to talk about the age thing. I would have, if we hadn't already spoken about it, I would have singled out the waiting period as something to keep in mind when thinking about that. But as regards age and that, I think my colleagues can probably speak more to that. And as well, I would also add that the bill doesn't seem to consider non-binary recognition, which is something that has been picked up by several European jurisdictions recently and would be something that that would render it, in my view, more human rights compliant. But that's obviously something we can talk about later if you'd prefer.
Yeah, so I know the Scottish Government has very clearly said that non-binary gender recognition is not going to form part of this process. And I also appreciate that I'm part of the Scottish Government's non-binary working group. And so when I say this, I should be very clear that this is my own personal opinion that I am expressing, not the expressions of the group. I do think that there is space, not as a matter necessarily of human rights or requirements, but of good policy reform to consider further the ways in which, if not the gender recognition reform bill, Scotland can make life easier for non-binary individuals, well, certainly the ways in which the law operates in other different spheres. That, as I say, is a personal opinion. When we think about young people, I think it's very welcome that we can see that the legislation provides for 16 and 17 year olds. We've seen in other jurisdictions which have adopted self-determination that they have, at least in some way, or not even that have adopted self-determinations, that have, I suppose, taken out the diagnosis requirement, because there we could also include the Netherlands, for example. They have extended legal gender recognition in some way to those who are under the age of 18. There's been no standard way in which that has been done. So, for example, you have some jurisdictions like Malta, like jurisdictions, for example, like Norway, jurisdictions like the Netherlands, which have taken out a diagnosis requirement and provided one system for all people over the age of 16. In Ireland, Portugal, Belgium, they've made it slightly more difficult, in some jurisdictions a lot more difficult, for young people who are 16 and 17 to be able to access legal gender recognition. Some jurisdictions have left it at 16. Scotland is choosing to do that. Other jurisdictions haven't. So places like Malta and Norway have allowed for children under the age of 16 to access legal gender recognition, but have done it on a much more conservative process involving parents, sometimes involving courts. I will admit to being probably slightly more conservative, and so I think for young people under the age of 16, having parental consent, having that involvement of other actors is a good thing. A lot of human rights actors would say not. There was a question which I will answer, which is that I think that there potentially could be space for children under the age of 16 to be provided in a quite supervised process, but to provide that possibility. I think if we are thinking, as we've talked about, the best interests of the child, the evolving capacities of the child, that absolute bright line at 16 presents issues. And the final thing I would say is, let's not just think for young people about legal gender recognition. Young people's lives are not, young people's lives rely upon the government providing adequate advice to schools, schools respecting their identities in key ways. In fact, I think that those on-the-ground policy and legislative reforms, through, for example, non-discrimination law, for some young people would be more important than having legal gender recognition. Thank you.
Was it only specifically around age that you wanted?
No, just any key aspects of the bill that you feel is relevant to bring up.
Okay, well, I think in Denmark, there's also this penal kind of sanction threat that's also included in the offence of making a false declaration that's been included in the bill. And I think if we're talking about sort of the spirit of the bill being one of inclusion, then this sort of threat of potential imprisonment is, it's at least interesting from an academic perspective the Danish trans people that I spoke to spoke about, you know, suspicion, level of suspicion from the state that this kind of threat of penal sanction would come with. So I don't know if that's been mentioned previously, but that was something that that looked quite, I don't know how to describe it, kind of heavy-handed in the bill, and something that I think is at least, would be maybe subject to criticism.
The question is, how would it operate, right? What does it mean to live in your gender? What would it mean to give a false declaration? Are we, after somebody obtains a gender recognition certificate, going to require them to engage in a very stereotypical, performative expression of their gender identity? And if they don't, have they committed fraud? And so I'd be interested, at least from your perspective, to consider more how that would apply in operation.
And just to add, if possible, some of the I interview some non-binary people in Denmark who present quite masculine or feminine, and so therefore chose to make use of the ability to change their legal gender within the confines of the legal binary which had been offered, which you might find is also something that was possible here in Scotland as well, that somebody who is non-binary identified but looks more masculine and was assigned female gender at birth might prefer to have a male legal gender, even if that doesn't really reflect their true gender identity, but just for practical purposes. And in that case, would that constitute a false declaration if they declare that they plan to live in the acquired gender for the rest of their life, when on a personal level they don't? You know, there's this threat of criminalisation is something that, to me seems a little bit heavy-handed.
Just to note as well that gender identity is often for the individual, not a fixed quantity. Gender can be fluid. Gender is, as Dr. Dietz says, something that perhaps a non-binary person feels more masculine, perhaps they feel more feminine, perhaps they feel outside the gender binary altogether. And how do we equate that lived experience and that the current human rights standard for sexual orientation and gender identity set by the Yogyakarta principles and the Y+10 documents, and they consider gender identity to be an internally felt thing and an innate attribute to the individual, which again it doesn't really correlate to something that has, you know, carceral terms and that has very standardised sort of, and as I mentioned in reply to Mr. McGregor, temporalised terms as well. So gender identity is something that can be a lot more fluid, a lot more changing, for a lot of people it is fixed, but it's not the case for everybody.
Thank you. Pam Gossel.
Good afternoon, panel, and thank you very much for your opening statements. My question is around the potential of these reforms to allow bad faith actors to obtain GRCs more easily. The self-ID-based gender recognition system in Victoria, Australia, includes additional checks and safeguards for applicants such as registered sex offenders and prisoners. Are there any other international examples of such additional checks that you're aware of? And do you believe these additional checks would provide an important additional safeguard? And my question will go to Dr. Duffy first, please.
Okay. I am personally not aware of other jurisdictions, especially in the European context, that have such limitations. That is not to say that there aren't any. It's just that personally, through my own research, I haven't encountered any. As regards the situation of, say, people who are incarcerated, obviously there are some points at which rights apply differentially. But so far we have not seen a diminution of, say, one's Article 8 ECHR right to legal gender recognition to be one of those rights when it comes to people in incarceration. Similarly, with regard to registered sex offenders, again, we need to consider exactly how much we're intruding on people's human rights in an unrelated area, if that makes sense, to the judicial process that they have already gone through. Personally, I am not a fan of the arguments around bad faith actors. I tend to believe that bad faith actor arguments are a problem that stem from cisgender men, not trans women. If you are arguing that a bad faith actor is going to try and obtain a GRC in order to gain access to women's spaces, which seems to be the main argument that is made against it, then I would say that that is not a trans person seeking a GRC. That is an abuser seeking a GRC. And internationally, that has not seemed to happen. Possibly because most cases of of sexual violence or anything like that happen on the actions of cisgender men. There isn't a GRC required in order for these people to to access women to victimise. And I tend to find that the bad faith actor arguments don't play out internationally. Again, I speak to the Irish jurisdiction. There hasn't been a rush of people seeking gender recognition certificates since self-ID began. It's been very steady. There hasn't been reports, as far as I'm aware, of crime happening, with regard to people trying to access, say, women's bathrooms or things like that in relation to having obtained a GRC. GRCs are for trans people to go about their daily lives. They are to promote the dignity and the inclusion of trans people. This is not something that we... This is the goal of the legislation. This is not something that we should forget because we are worried that potentially cisgender men might abuse it. And again, as I say, that has not been something that has played out in what I have seen in my research.
Thank you.
So I would say quite similar. So certainly within the European context, I'm not aware of jurisdictions basically placing limitations on people who are serving custodial sentences from being able to access legal gender recognition. And I think, of course, we have to consider those balancing of rights. So when you go into the carceral system, absolutely, you don't have the same enjoyment of all of the rights that you have. So, for example, your Article 5 rights to liberty. What we do sort of see is that you do, however, retain some key rights. And so you'd retain that right to private life, to personal development, which we see under the European Convention on Human Rights, is the core of your right to legal gender recognition. Now, of course, we have to think about exceptions. And what you actually think, what you see within the UK and what you see within Scotland, is when you do this comparative analysis of different jurisdictions in Europe, actually the UK is quite interesting in that we have specifically provided for carve-outs and exceptions where we think that there's going to be bad faith actors. So actually some of the protections that we would want to see within segregated spaces, for example, within sport, within prisons, already exist. And there's no reason to suggest why those also wouldn't work under this new system. If having a gender recognition certificate doesn't guarantee you access to a prison, or when you're in a prison, doesn't guarantee you being able to change a state, well then there's no reason to understand, there's no reason to question why that case-by-case analysis couldn't happen. I actually happen to believe that when we're legislating, we do need to think about what's not just probable, but what's also potential. I think that's an appropriate way in which we consider. However, what I do slightly worry about is where we seem on the conversation about gender recognition to always start from the image of the trans rapist, of the person in the bathroom who's going to mug you, of the cisgender man who's going to try and game the social welfare system. I think I would ask, where else, I suppose, do we start from a position by saying, we think this is, there are key policy reasons to adopt this legislative reform, and we think that this reform would be appropriate and would make people's lives better. Where else do we start from the position of saying, well, actually, we're going to start by looking at the potential abuses. We're not going to look at the merits of the reform. We're going to look at the potential abuses. I would say, let's look at the system that exists. Let's see, can we approve it, as this, I think, bill does. And then let's see, what are the potential problems? What are the potential abuses? And let's create appropriate exceptions. And I would say, if there's anything that's welcome about this debate, it's that we're finally talking about abuse of women in public spaces, in private spaces, in prisons. Let's focus more upon that and upon the male perpetrators of violence, rather than, I suppose, trying to scapegoat the trans community. Because whether or not this legislation passes, women are still going to experience abuse in the home, in places of, in public spaces. Let's put our efforts towards that. As a family lawyer, I would very much support that approach. Thank you.
Clear on that, Peter. In no way am I saying that these trans people are these bad faith actors. Unfortunately, there are people out there. It's not the trans people. That's why I'm focusing on this, because people have asked that question, that people may say they're trans and use that, which is absolutely wrong. And these bad faith actors could end up, you know, if they've got the GRC, think that that's something there, that they can go into these places. So that's why I'm asking more about the safeguards to make sure that we don't let these people in and make sure that we're fair. But no way am I saying any trans people are like that.
And I personally actually believe that we have to have these conversations about safeguards. And good people within academia would maybe sort of think about, well, what is the limit of that conversation? I think we do, but I suppose we have to kind of apply the same legislative standards to this legislation as we would with anyone else. And, you know, it seems that that's what you're doing, so I think it's great to see. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. And Dr. Chris, is there anything you want to add to that?
Only to add that I'm not aware of any evidence of systematic misuse of self-declaration in Denmark or in any of the other jurisdictions that have adopted self-declaration legislation.
I've just got one more additional question on this. Is there anything that you've got that you can compare from internationally, whether it's in Europe or outside, when it comes to religious rights? Making sure that, you know, that we don't take anybody's rights away, whether it's trans rights or religious, and that we work in a balance. So is there anything out there that you've experienced or seen or can speak about, that how we can balance both rights, whether it's to single-sex spaces or whether it's to single-sex services?
I come at this from the point of view that trans women are women and trans men are men. And therefore, if a trans woman is accessing a woman's space, then she is in the correct place. I am not aware of religious exemptions in other laws, although there might. I'm not aware of them, but from my point of view, like I said, if a trans woman is in a women's space, then she's a woman and she's allowed in that space.
Just on that, how do you feel about the religious people that are a minority, groups out there that feel that their religion will be impacted if somebody else is in that space? And so when you say trans women will be a trans woman and trans man will be a trans man, obviously, how do you feel about that? That we've heard this from one of our private sessions, that basically it would exclude more women and girls from minority groups. So just if you don't know an example, it'd be good to hear from your thoughts on that. That how do you see that basically they wouldn't be affected if a trans woman came into that changing room or that space service? Or
again, I can only say that I come at this from the perspective that a trans woman is a woman like me or like any other. I appreciate the question. I think it's quite a difficult one to negotiate without wanting to harm either the minorities you're referring to or the tiny minority of society that is the trans community. I think this is possibly something Peter could speak to when it comes to exemptions and exceptions and equality laws slightly better than I could. So I might...
I think I'm going to be quite a letdown on that. I wouldn't. So what I would say is a couple of things. I think what might be good to consider is the work that the UN Special Rapporteur on Freedom of Religion has done, because he's looked at issues of gender and he's looked at potential conflicts around issues of LGBT rights, gender and freedom of religion. And I think he's come to quite a nuanced perspective on that. So he might actually be somebody, certainly you could look at his reports, but he also might be somebody to consider in evidence. I would say that I'm not aware of any legislative build in. What I would say is that, you know, there are jurisdictions around the world, in Asia, in Europe, in South America, in North America, which have adopted self-identification laws. And so there might be at the local level either specific local rules or there might be individual practices. And that's something which I'm certainly happy to look at further if it would be useful to give you follow-up information around that. As somebody who comes from quite a religious background, I'm quite sympathetic to the religious perspective. But once again, I think that we have to realistically think about how that balancing works. And I think we have to kind of say objectively, well, what are the potential rights that are at conflict here? I would certainly say that there always is the possibility of a conflict of rights. And sometimes we have to come to complex compromises. And I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. But once again, I would sort of suggest, let's realistically and objectively obsess whether or not that conflict really exists, because I think too often sometimes we're very quick to see the conflict, but where it does, absolutely, let's have a conversation about balancing people's rights.
I mean, just on that, Peter, if you do have any information, it'd be great for the committee to see that, that how we can balance both rights. I think it's about having that balance and respecting both rights. But there certainly is from, you know, we have heard basically there are people that are feeling that. So we mustn't make sure that we can balance that. So if there's anything that you could send to the committee, it'd be really welcome. Thank you.
Rachel's on a brief intervention.
It's brief. It's just to get some examples of countries that have impact studies on the particular issues that Pam has just explored. If you may, thank you.
I'm not sure if there is, but absolutely very, very happy to look at. I'm very much happy to look at it. Off the top of my head, I haven't actually seen anything which specifically looks at that issue, but there may very well be, and we can certainly ask connections.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. And Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon to the panel. Thank you for the evidence you've given so far and also for the information you submitted in advance, which we found incredibly helpful. A lot of the questions that I had have kind of already been covered, with the exception of a couple, so I'll focus on that. You've touched on this, but can you tell us from experience elsewhere, are there any countries who have monitored the impact of self-identification on the use of single-sex spaces?
I'm not aware of research on that from the countries that I would be conversant with the law in. If you wanted to expand on the question, then I could maybe give some more information, but I'm not currently aware of research on that.
So I guess we have this issue where people have presented to us concerns about the risks associated with self-identification and the risks to women. And we heard some fairly compelling evidence actually this morning from the SHRC on that matter. But I'm aware that countries elsewhere have done this, and they've done it for quite some time. For example, Argentina has done it now for nearly 10 years. So I'm I guess as a legislator, I'm asking you, what did other legislators do about this? How did they navigate that particular issue?
If I can speak to the Danish case, I mean, one of the things that came up in the parliamentary debates in Denmark was this access to single-sex spaces. So it's not like kind of post-legislative review, but it was something that was discussed there. And one of the ways that the minister who was involved for presenting the legislation to the parliament said was, you know, that these aren't new issues and they're not going to be significantly affected by the passing of self-declaration legislation. And I think that seemed to be the view in the previous session as well, that whether you have a gender recognition certificate or not doesn't necessarily determine whether you can access a single-sex space. So I think in that respect that they had a similar approach in Denmark, and the minister said, you know, people who run leisure centres or they do deal with these things. They have dealt with these things in the past, and they'll come up with solutions. And I guess it's kind of a hands off approach from the government, which could be criticised. But I agree with you. It seemed quite compelling this morning in relation to what this specific bill, the effect of it would be. It's sort of hard to determine.
Thank you. Did you have something to add, Dr. Duff?
Yeah, so I suppose what you said is I think the reality is, I would be pretty confident to say that I don't think there is a significant amount of research out there which has looked at specifically the question of monitoring. And so there's no point, I wouldn't equivocate on that from my perspective. I don't think there is. But I do think there's a couple of things. So first of all, we have seen a review of the legislation. So we talked about the 2-year review in Ireland, and many issues were raised about potential difficulties with the legislation in that particular jurisdiction. One of them, which wasn't raised, was the fear that it was being misused. So there didn't seem to be, in this government report, any indication that Ireland, which is actually quite a good comparator jurisdiction in terms of size of population and legal culture, is quite a good example of potentially what might happen. So we haven't seen abuse in Ireland, and certainly I would say anecdotally I could add to that and say I haven't heard of abuse. What was interesting when we did a review, so with my colleague Dr. Marilyn van den Brink in 2017 and 2018, we looked at different laws across the European Union and certain EFTA member states. And what we were really surprised to see was, as Chris has sort of said, is that there wasn't a huge number of jurisdictions, even those jurisdictions which adopted self-determination, which had specifically provided for this type of legal rule. It seemed to operate more on the basis of a kind of a common social understanding. The one jurisdiction that did stand out for having quite a clear regulated framework in terms of who can and can't access single-sex spaces was the United Kingdom. And so actually we might think that there are potentially the framework that we already have existing in this jurisdiction potentially could be more robust than would exist in other jurisdictions. The final what I would say is that there has been more general studies in the last 2 years or so about how legal gender recognition operates in the Council of Europe and happens in the European Union. And no, they have not specifically looked at how single-sex spaces might be effective. And so therefore, the relevance for the question that you've asked has to be considered and has to be lessened. That's just a fact. But what we once again don't see is massive concerns being raised by the possibility that this has had a material impact in terms of creating unsafer spaces. Once again, it's one of those things where I absolutely do think it's something that you have to take into account. But I think we also, once again, need to be realistic in terms of the threat. And if that sort of potential risk exists, putting in place appropriate safeguards. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Duffy?
I was also going to point to the Irish review and how this did not seem, with regard to the report anyway, that from the committee that actually reviewed the bill, did not seem to be a problem, did not seem to be something that was raising concern. As I've said before, there hasn't been a rush on gender recognition certificates in Ireland. As I've also said before, this is an issue where we're not talking about trans people anymore, mm-hmm. You know?
Yep.
We're no longer talking about the actual community that this legislation is aimed at. We're talking about bad faith actors from another community. I think the UK, as Dr. Dunn has mentioned, has quite a robust framework with regard to who can access what space and what exemptions and exceptions apply. I am not sure that the bill that we're debating and adjudicating on here today would actually impact that much, if that makes sense, that we already have a framework for these kind of things, that depathologizing Scottish gender recognition law would probably not have such a huge effect on current kind of equalities law and that for the whole of the UK.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And I also appreciate your reminder that this is about looking at what we can do for trans people. That's an important reminder. Thank you. Thanks. That's all I have.
OK, thanks very much. Well, thanks to all three of you. It's been quite a long session over the course of today, and I know everyone's been kind of watching all the sessions. So thanks so much for helping us with our stage one inquiry. That concludes the public part of our meeting. We'll now move into private for the final item on our agenda.